Now, what is Burnley really famous for, Michael?
Eccles cakes.
Very, very early morning sports radio for postmen. Bullwick. Trolley dollies.
Out of a dirt chip, Prestwick.
And anyone who had to do a dawn runner after a very ill-advised one-night stand.
Go, go, go.
Over my dead body.
The two mics on Talk Sport.
Look at the light!
Disastrous.
This is TalkSport. We are the two mics. It's time to say a very, very good morning on quite a somber night, I suppose, to Mr. Mike Porky Parry. Very good morning to you, Mr. Parry.
Yeah, good morning. It was a spectacular occasion at Wembley tonight, for all the wrong reasons, of course. But nevertheless, it was a talk about a unison of two countries who came together as one. Mm. And, you know, we've had our differences with France over the last 400 or 500 years. Yeah. You know, the Hundred Years' War was between France and England. And very complicated relationship over the years. Going back to, you know, back to the Middle Ages, some of the kings of England only spoke French and lived in France and all this kind of stuff, you know. So the unison between the two countries has always been close, occasionally been at war. But what a bonding that was last night. And
it was a great moment. I mean, for me, it was almost the making, as I just said there. We don't normally play a clip in an opener like that long, but I thought you had to play the whole thing because it was almost like the making of the new Wembley, you know, because the old Wembley had so many things and memories that people would remember.
Yeah, I know what you
mean.
For me,
nothing's really happened at Wembley that has been particularly memorable. Whereas that tonight, I think, will sit now in the pantheon of time.
Yeah,
I think people will look back on it over years and years and years and go, that was amazing.
I think it's a very good point that, Mike. But the other images that struck me were that the old Wembley, you would never, ever have seen volleys of policemen walking around with submachine guns.
True.
Guarding football fans. No. And that's the difference. When I went there for the first time ever in 1966... Mm. People drifted around in total freedom, total safety, total security. Yeah. The most intimidating thing you heard all day was, you got any spares? Yeah. You know, for people who wanted a ticket to try and get in. And the worst act of terrorism were guys who had climbed up the outside walls to try and get through the open windows to get into Wembley. Without paying, absolutely.
Sure.
Well, they would have paid, they just couldn't get a ticket, you know.
It just tells you how things have changed.
Well, things
I mean, what we knew about, obviously, the game in Paris last Friday. Germany had their game against the Netherlands called off because of a similar sort of threat that they believed was too much to actually play the game against.
Yeah, I mean, you know, the world has changed so dramatically now. What happened to you the first time you went to an airport and saw a policeman standing there with a Heckler & Koch machine gun strapped across his chest?
Right.
These things are just the way that the world has developed during your lifetime and mine.
Yeah.
I tell you what I think is interesting. Maybe I'm deluded, but I had an innate confidence tonight that nothing would go wrong at Wembley. Mm. And that's for two reasons. Mm. Firstly, I think we're very good at keeping a terrorist threat controllable, if you see what I mean. I think we're good at keeping...
Well, I mean, it's easy to say that, though, isn't it? But, I mean, unfortunately, as the famous phrase from the IRA goes, you know, you have to be lucky all the time. We only have to be lucky once.
That's absolutely true. But what I'm saying is, I have got confidence in our security services to keep, you know, a very, very close eye on the movement of anything which is a threat to the nation.
Yeah.
I may be deluded, but, you know, that's the way I feel. But secondly, what struck me was that the cowards who go around blowing people away by just spraying a machine gun into a crowd or through a window of a restaurant or blowing themselves up and hoping to take loads of people with them, they always do it where they're successful in unexpected circumstances. Yeah. Tonight, of course, there was a huge preparation for the potential of trouble.
Sure.
And so they don't seem to go to those places, you see what I mean?
Yeah.
They pick on the innocent, that they strike when
well,
you least expect it.
Well, they go for easier targets, don't they?
They go for soft targets.
I mean, and you might have said last night in London, there were many other targets that would have been a lot easier.
Well, you're absolutely right. And it's not a soft target to them, I suppose, if there are other people in the vicinity who've got a machine and can fire back.
Yeah.
They don't like people firing back at them, you know. And despite this you know, this maxim of theirs that the Westerners like life but we like death, you know, death, if it comes too soon, nullifies the horrific purpose of their mission
people. If they wanted to fight that badly, why didn't they just stay in Syria and fight in Syria where, you know, there's a likelihood they could get shot any single day of the week?
Because they despise the West and want to bring it down, don't they? So that's what they think they're going to do. But it'll take an awful lot more than the attacks in Paris to even have the slightest dent in the lifestyle and the way of life of the Western world. Mm. Horrific and horrendous as Paris was, we're strong enough as a Western society to come back and say, OK, we've taken that, we've been knocked down, we get up again and we have to get on with it. And just carry the enormous grief and sorrow of all the families involved.
Did you see that amazing message, which is one of those things that went viral yesterday from one of he's the husband of one of the victims, basically.
Yes.
Who was shot dead. I think she was expecting her second child. He's now got to look after their 2-year-old on his own.
Yeah.
But he basically sent out this kind of statement, saying, I'm not going to waste much time on you people.
Yes.
But, you know, me and my son are two people who are stronger than any army in the world, and we will continue to live in the way that we live.
Yes.
And we will continue to sort of, you know, disappoint you every day by being happy.
Yes, absolutely.
Simple as that.
Yeah,
you know,
that's great.
Very
that's
powerful.
It's a great thing.
I probably
to
haven't
say.
Quite done it justice, but an awful lot of people are saying those kinds of things. Are just saying, you know, who the hell do you think you are?
Sure.
Coming here and shooting people.
Yeah, the government political situation's an odd one, isn't it? We seem to be the only country now who's not committed through its own parliament to join the attack on ISIS in Syria.
And Cameron's now urging that something needs to be done. I mean, yesterday he said we can't just sit back and do nothing and hope that it all goes away, because that's not going to happen.
Mm.
And so now, apparently, we're going to have to be... he's going to have to face whether putting another vote to the parliament and risking losing it or doing something completely different, you know. So we shall see how that all pans out.
What's his completely different option?
Well, his completely different option, I suppose, would be just to say, right, well, we're going to go and do it. We're not going to go through parliament.
Yeah. Well, he's done that recently, hasn't he? When we struck with drones, and he did address Parliament and say we got rid of people who are the enemy, and therefore it was an act of self-defence.
Right.
So if he judges that through his military advisers that it's an act of self-defence, I suppose we go. But he looks pretty embarrassed on the political stage, doesn't he? That other countries, Russia, France and America, are able to muster support internally in their own political systems to attack ISIS in Syria, and we can't. It's a terribly difficult one, Mike, because, you know, for a long time I was of the view that you don't interfere in other countries' politics by going around and bombing one tribe or the other, because most Middle East countries are made up of tribes which are centuries old in their development. And you go around saying, well, they're the good guys and they're the bad guys, because the total irony of what happens if we go and start attacking people in Syria, ISIS, is that we're actually going to be attacking people we wouldn't have attacked if we'd have got the vote to go and bomb Syria last time it was put to Parliament.
And bomb Assad, and that's where it's complicated as well, because also the people who are fleeing Syria, who may or may not include some people who are terrorists from ISIS, are actually fleeing Assad.
Yes, that's
so,
right.
So, you know, when we went before, we wanted to
unbelievable.
Go... You know, so they're not... It's not the same... it's not the same thing.
The vote this time is to go and bomb people in Syria, but a different load of people to the ones we wanted to bomb last time.
That's right, yeah.
It's very weird.
It is.
Yeah.
It's very complicated. Mm. But we will try and figure a lot of it out.
Indeed.
And we'll be talking tonight as well about Jonah Lomu, who died suddenly just before this show
started. Shocking news, that is.
Very shocking news.
Shocking news, 40 years of age.
And he was here during the World Cup, and he was kind of, you know, involved in various things. Saw him on TV a couple of times.
Smiling, happy face.
Yeah, I mean, he's obviously suffered for many years with kidney problems, all the rest of it. But we'll be trying to get a guest on that. We'll be talking to Simon Johnson, who was at Wembley last night as well. We'll try and figure out what's going on with winners and losers, too, because it's still 50-50 at this point. And I'd said I was going to call a halt to the voting at one. So we may have to come up with some way of deciding whether to call it a draw or whether to try and...
What happened to the midnight deadline?
Well, the midnight deadline came and it was 50-50. So if you want, we can call
it 50-50. It was exactly 50-50.
It is exactly 50% each.
Who's gerrymandering this?
Nobody is. It can't be done.
Somebody must be.
No.
You must have some operation
in here. Why are you so suspicious?
To make sure you don't lose.
No. I've lost three times.
I think you've got some sort of trapdoor
I've lost three times. No, I've lost three times. It's 9-3 to me. If you want, we can call it a draw, or we can keep the vote open for another 2 hours and wait and see what happens. But I mean,
I think we should keep the vote open until 3 o'clock.
Okay.
That's what I'll say to you, people.
That's what Porky wants to do. I mean, the thing is, what you don't realise is that every single thing you've asked for, I've given you.
Vote
every
Porky.
Every single time you ask for a change to the system,
vote Porky.
I give it to you. Every time you ask for your name to be put at the top, I do it. Every time you ask for to go first or second, I let you do it.
Vote Porky,
the
vote
The only
often.
Gerrymandering going on here is from you.
I don't think so.
This is Talk Sport.
Don't phone your mother. Phone Talk Sport.
Football. 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 On DAB Digital Radio and 1089 and 1053 AM.
Atletico Radio.
Talk Sport. Better catch your own train.
This is Talk Sport. We are the two mics. Of course, there will be a podcast coming out. It's Ask Porky coming up a little bit later on in the show as well. We've got loads and loads of questions from Mr. Parry, which we will get through both from Facebook and from Twitter. Lots of people have got things to say about the winners and losers. Zobon says, Porky, I see the big L coming your way. So if you know what's good for you, change back to the old way of voting. Mm. Lots of people have been saying that the new way of voting is confusing. Some of them are saying that they can't find it.
What do you mean confusing?
I think. On the statistics that we've got,
exactly
1,644 people have now voted, right? Which is a massive record.
Yes,
last week it was a record of 1,300 and something.
That's right.
So I mean, almost
so
I
more
mean,
and more people are accessing it under the new voting system,
which I think has to be a good thing.
So can I just say for you lot out there complaining that it's too complicated, I would say you're dumbbells.
Yeah,
because
the people that were complaining that the last system wasn't right either.
That's right.
Who you supported because you weren't winning.
Yes,
you're supporting people who you're now denigrating people who are not in favour of it on the basis that you might win this.
I don't denigrate anybody. I'm not a denigrator, believe me. Mm. I'm an appreciator. And I want to appreciate every single one of our listeners. But if you can't work out how to vote for me, please try harder. Remember, if you're not winning this live, it's because you're not trying hard enough.
Yeah, and the score's 9-3 at the moment, right? So it'll either be 10-3 or we could just declare it a draw at any point. I mean,
we might have to do that.
Or what I was thinking, I'd have to obviously get your assent for this one.
Yeah.
What I thought was you could also retweet or like it.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah?
Yeah.
And so if you retweet or like it, we could make that the final vote as well. Because if it's going to...
What, you mean you want a second stage of voting?
Yeah, well, you see how right now it says 50-50 on the actual... on the two names.
Yes.
Right? Underneath that, there are retweets and likes.
Okay.
Now, it might be the only way to...
I'll go for that.
Would you like to be retweeted or liked?
I'd like to be retweeted, please.
All right, so Porky will now be retweeted. So if you go to the top of the Two Mics Twitter page...
Yes, that's it.
And you look
that's
at
it.
Where the pinned thing is, which is the vote. Mm-hmm. You can vote as many... you can't vote as many times as you like, but you can vote until 3 o'clock.
Mm-hmm.
But you can also retweet or like it until 3 o'clock.
Mm-hmm.
And then when we get to that point, we will declare the winner.
Mm.
Seems exciting, doesn't it?
Okay, that sounds very exciting to me.
Now let's talk about the shocking story of Jonah Lomu.
Is that terrible?
Literally just before this show started,
it's absolutely terrible.
The news broke that at the age of 40, and unexpectedly, I mean, even though we knew that he'd had problems with his kidneys before,
yes.
He had to quit the game probably prematurely. Yep. He had a kidney transplant back in 2004, but that stopped functioning in 2011.
Mm.
And as I say, he was here as recently as last month when the Rugby World
Cup
was on.
Yeah. Yeah.
And doing all sorts of appearances and appearing on TV and all that. Yeah. And suddenly, at some point or other, over the last few hours, he obviously became very ill and died.
Yeah, I know. It's terrible because what you always think in these situations, Mike, is that these people have a gifted life.
Mm.
And if you've got a gifted life because you're one of the greatest rugby players ever to have been born and played and you become a worldwide iconic hero,
you're
not supposed to then have some terrible crippling disease which debilitates you, curtails your genius, but also literally put your life under threat. Yeah. That's not supposed to happen. When you're a David Beckham...
Especially if you're a sports star and your body is kind of what makes you what you are.
Exactly. You know, if you're a David Beckham or if you're Usain Bolt, I should say, you are not supposed to suffer from, you know, physical debilitation. It doesn't make sense, does it?
No, it doesn't. But very sad. We're going to be talking to Christian Cullen, former All Black, later on in the hour.
Yeah.
He's going to give us his thoughts on it. But the Prime Minister has come out, John Key, the New Zealand Prime Minister. The thoughts of the entire country are with his family, he says. So he was a giant of the game, but also he was one of those figures who rose above the game, didn't he?
Oh, he did, definitely. And also, I mean, I've never been to New Zealand, actually, but I've worked with New Zealanders who've tried to convey to me the size of rugby and the effect it has on people's lives in New Zealand.
Yeah.
You know, in much the same way as football here has a, you know, a huge effect on everybody, almost 24 hours a day, 7 days a week sometimes. Yeah. Rugby and the All Blacks and all that is as consuming to the New Zealand people in their own country. And so when you rise right to the top of that particular culture, you must literally have been the giant of New Zealand, you know, the most famous man and all this kind of stuff. You know what I mean? I suppose it's a bit like us losing David Beckham, really. Yeah. God, you know, bless and God prevent and all that kind of stuff. Mm. But I suppose it is. And the sense of shock in that country must be enormous. Maybe maybe in New Zealand, maybe people in New Zealand knew a little bit more about the depth to which John Aluma was fighting his illness.
The death has been called unexpected. As much as we knew that he wasn't, you know, his kidney, the kidney problems did persist. Mm. There was certainly no evidence when he was here during the Rugby World Cup.
No, it wasn't.
That there was anything wrong with him.
No, absolutely.
And I think people are genuinely shocked about it.
They will.
He scored 43 tries for the All Blacks, and of course you'll remember in 1994. When he made his test debut against France in Christchurch. That was when everybody first realised that here's a guy that not only...
He's only 18, I think, wasn't he?
But they were like, he was so big, he was like, we can't even stop this guy.
No, that's right. And then it was the following year, 95, wasn't it, when he literally trampled across the England defence in the semi-final of the World Cup to establish himself as the greatest player in the world.
I saw him playing in 99 at the Rugby World Cup, which was based in Wales.
Yes.
I think I'm right in saying that New Zealand played off for third place with France.
Right.
And they lost.
Right.
And Joe Lomu by then was beginning to look like he was a bit disinterested. I think it was the beginning of him having sort of
illnesses.
Yes, and he just wasn't as good as he should be. But we'll talk to Christian Cullen about that
coming up
in a little while. We've got lots of other things to talk about, of course. What did you make of the game last night, apart from the else? I was wondering whether, because England were not really under any pressure, because it was kind of a game where the football didn't really matter, that actually the players seemed to play with a bit more freedom. They seemed to play with a little bit more kind of... less nerves, it would seem.
Well, maybe they knew it was because the focus wasn't actually on itself.
But that's what I mean.
Yeah, and it was on.
Because I actually quite enjoyed the game for the first time in a long time watching an England game.
I couldn't honestly really concentrate on the game because I know I've already made a soliloquy saying I never thought there would be trouble tonight. But nevertheless, your ear is always waiting for a noise, isn't it? Or some indication of a disturbance in the crowd or something like that. You know what I mean? Because of the terrible situations. I mean, the one thing I would say about the game, and I suppose you could predict I would say this, is I thought John Stones was absolutely fantastic again. I really did. I thought he was terrific. But the man of the match has to be young Dele Alli, isn't it? It's got to be.
What a great goal.
Oh, unbelievable. Mm. And what confidence he showed to have summoned that sort of ability together on a massive
platform.
But
isn't that what England have failed to do in the past?
You know,
they brought perhaps younger players in and then they suddenly haven't looked like themselves. You know, they haven't produced their club form. They've looked as if they've been in a straitjacket and they've been frightened to do anything.
Yeah.
And he wasn't frightened to do anything.
Yeah. I totally agree with you. Mm. Earlier today, I put out a tweet saying that I thought Wayne Rooney had grown into the captaincy by the dignity and the solemnity with which he'd spoken about the tragedy in France, and the responsibilities for every Englishman and every English player tonight. And as usual, I got a bit of grief, why are you always going on about Rooney? But I genuinely did think that he handled it extremely well when he was addressing the nation.
And he actually played like a captain as well.
Well, I was about to say, I think that translated into his form tonight because I think he had one of his best ever games for England. He looked like he was in control of things.
That point in the first half when he nearly scored.
Yeah, and then the volley that was his goal. I thought he was terrific. So,
and did you check the minute when he scored in the second half?
Was it the 47th?
It was.
Was it? Indeed. Yeah. That comes out. Funny enough, somebody tweeted me at night and said that minute comes up again. I didn't know what they were talking about. I hadn't registered the two. But as you've just told me, then obviously I've registered now.
Yes. Excellent. Yes. Right. Well, coming up, we're going to speak to Simon Johnson, who was at the game for the Evening Standard. We'll find out from him what it was like to actually be there.
Yeah.
Obviously, TalkSport carried the commentary live as well. It was a pretty magnificent kind of opening to any football game. And it was a game that actually, if you were not necessarily a purist of an international sort of situation, it was actually quite an enjoyable game.
Yeah.
But we'll find out from him what Dele Alli's future
indeed.
Is in the England lineup.
Indeed.
Will he actually be in the starting 11 in the Euro finals? Mm. We shall see.
Talk Sport.
And it's in!
A diving header at the end of a 50-yard run.
From the root to the tip.
Talk Sport.
This is Talk Sport. We are the two mics. Of course, there will be a podcast coming out a little bit later on. It is Ask Porky tonight as well, which we'll be getting stuck into a little bit later
Sure is.
We've got lots going on, in fact. So one of the things that we need to do, of course, is to... what have I done here? I have to set off my information device.
What are you doing?
I was just trying to
What are you fiddling around with these machines for? Why can't you concentrate on the audience?
Well, I do concentrate on the audience.
Good enough to tune in at this time of night.
Well, I have to concentrate on the audience, but because you're so incapable of reading anything while the show is on, I have to do all the reading while everything else is
happening.
We've
got people all around the world tuning in. They want an absorbing show full of information, full of observation full of little asides which lighten up their lives. And all you can do is switch on your blinking tablet, however you want to call it these
That's
days.
A phone.
And all of a sudden, blast down the airwaves a load of gobbledygook.
No, what
it's
I was
not good enough.
To, what I was trying to find for you, actually, was something that I thought you might be interested in, because there was a young lady by the name of LaDonna Harvey, who we speak to from time to time, who works for a state radio station over in San Diego.
Indeed.
And after Charlie Sheen went on NBC, I think it was, yesterday morning, to declare that he was HIV positive, they managed to speak to somebody who knew him rather well.
Right.
He was a former call girl who worked for somebody called Heidi Fleiss.
Right, yeah, I remember Heidi Fleiss, of course I do.
And she described some of the things that she had done in the company of Charlie Sheen and talked about, you know, how he was a guy that needed to get a grip of his life and how basically, you know, it was all very well for him to say that he was being blackmailed and he was being pushed into this situation. Mm. But as she said, it takes two to tango.
Yeah.
And this is a guy who spent most of his life being incredibly reckless, addicted to all manner of things from, you know, sex to drugs to rock and roll to whatever else. And I was just trying to find her name there, but unfortunately the video played and that was why the little noise came out.
Yeah, well...
So that was what I was doing.
Not good enough. Now,
I'm not sitting here playing some kind of video game.
Yeah, well, you look as though you are. Now, Charlie Sheen, OK, so he was a budding actor. Now, I remember him, wasn't he in Wall Street?
He certainly was.
He was in Wall Street with his dad, right?
One of his great performances, actually.
It was a great performance. And I thought then, you know, he played the guy who was a bit misled and tried to gain a fortune instantly, but learnt the lesson at the end and went off to jail. And he thought, well, I wonder if that's a sort of parody of his life and all that kind of stuff, when he started misbehaving himself. Now, the attitude now is, oh, Charlie Sheen, you know, Hollywood's worst hellraiser. Mm. I'm sorry, in my view, Charlie Sheen is a nasty, horrible little criminal, because if he had HIV positive and he was still sleeping with thousands of women in the last 4 years, then he's potentially delivered to these women that he's had physical sex with a death sentence, and I think it's an outrage.
Well,
an absolute outrage.
Well, you may think it's an outrage, and one of the things that Alex Datig said about that was, and she's the former call girl who was speaking on KOGO radio, was that, yeah, I mean, it may well be that if it turns out that he has, you know, knowingly knowingly and recklessly put women at risk, then that might be the case. He's certainly not a criminal as we stand at the moment, because he has not been charged with any crime and he's not been convicted of any crime. You can't call him that. You can say that he may have potentially... potentially done something criminal, but at the moment you can't call him a criminal.
Excuse me, Mike, you weren't listening to me. Criminal with a small C is what he's done is, in my view, criminal.
Yeah.
Right? I'm not calling him a criminal.
Yeah.
I'm saying he is criminal in his act of what he's done. Now he's got HIV positive, right, and going around and sleeping with women all over the place is an absolute disgrace. What a disgusting man. What a horrible, disgusting man to go and infect other human beings with the disease he picked up because of his own inability to curb his desires to act like the most irresponsible human being in the history of man.
Well,
it's an absolute disgrace.
I don't think there's going to be anybody out there who's got any sympathy for him. And as this former core girl said, if he's worried about the fact that he's been forced into this situation because some horrible people around him have been blackmailing him, then, as she said, you know, he's put himself in that situation.
Yeah, but they've been blackmailing him because they
found
out...
But what you have to realise is that Charlie Sheen was living in this netherworld, right?
Yeah.
Which none of us really would understand. None of us would ever get anywhere near. And none of us would
even... Well, if you know you've got a highly contagious disease,
I mean, you're looking at this from the point of view of a man who lives a relatively sedate life in a relatively, in a normal part of the world where you don't go to these kind of parties. I mean, this guy was having parties with porn stars. I mean, this girl said that she was called to one of his birthday parties.
Yes.
She was paid $5,000 along with three other girls to go and party, basically, with Charlie Sheen, i.e. have sex with him, and an entire baseball team.
Yeah.
Right? I mean, now, I wouldn't know anything about going to a party like that. You've talked about, you know, various footballers who get up to no good at various points in their careers. But, you know, these people are mixing with porn stars, with prostitutes, with drug users, you know, with drug dealers.
And he picks up HIV.
But my point is that these are the people with whom he has been consorting. Mm. And so, you know, many of them might want to look at themselves and say, well, if you're going to go into that kind of room and you're going to get involved in that kind of thing, then you're going to have to risk an awful lot. And it's not worth it.
Isn't he subject now to the potential of being sued for hundreds of millions of pounds?
Very possibly.
Yeah.
Very possibly.
For what he's done.
And he may well be prosecuted. I mean, it may well be that there is some kind of, you know, court action brought against him criminally. Because, but I mean, what we don't know is you know, who's going to come forward and talk about that?
Well, I've no idea. But I'm telling you, to have that attitude in your life and to knowingly go to bed and sleep with other people, knowing that you're carrying one of the most deadly diseases known to man.
Well, HIV actually isn't deadly now anymore because, you know, you can now keep HIV at bay, providing you've got the drugs to do it.
You know, you can get a course of tablets for the rest of your life and keep it at bay.
Yeah, but, back in the 80s, if you got HIV, that was a death sentence.
Because it went into full-blown AIDS.
Because you would get AIDS.
But nevertheless, it's not very nice to pass on HIV to anybody when you know you've got it.
No, it's not.
It's disgusting.
No, it's not.
Now,
but, I mean, if you were involved with somebody like Charlie Sheen and you were stupid enough to have unprotected sex with Charlie Sheen, then surely, you know, then you have to have some blame laid at your door as well because, you know who Charlie Sheen is, you know where he's been, you know what he's done.
I can't
imagine anybody in their right mind getting involved with Charlie Sheen and not realising that that was a risk they were taking.
Do you remember the guy who was in Psycho?
What?
The actor.
Norman Bates,
yeah. What was his name?
Anthony Perkins.
Yeah. Do you remember the famous story about when he was interviewed on, some chat show in America?
Mm.
And he was, you know, because he's kept the secret, hasn't he, this HIV for 4 years, Charlie Sheen. And the reason he was being interviewed was it had been announced that he'd got AIDS and he was dying. Because in those days, you quite rightly say, HIV usually resulted in full-blown AIDS.
Yeah.
And the interview was, and so... it must have been a terrible moment for you when, you know, you were first told that you had AIDS.
Yeah.
And he said, well, I never was told. And the guy interviewing him said, well, how did you find out? He said, I read it on the front of the National Enquirer.
Yeah, right.
And the interviewer said, what do you mean? He said, yes. He said, my blood samples went off to a laboratory. He said, before they came back and I was told what the result of them was, one of the laboratory technicians had sold the results to the National Enquirer and they published them ahead of my being told.
Well, and this story very much went in the same direction.
I mean,
the National Enquirer has been running stories not naming the Hollywood star involved.
Sure.
But then finally naming him just before he decided to come out and say that it was him. But also a couple of websites were doing it as well. It was definitely a story that was doing the rounds. And that is the problem with something like this. It's very difficult to keep it secret.
Sure. Oh, yeah, of course it is. Yeah, but I mean, what I just find unbelievable is that you already going down the road of, oh, you can forgive him for his lifestyle.
I didn't say that.
Because of the sort of guy he was.
No, I didn't say
that. Yes, you can.
No, I didn't say that. When did I say anything like that?
You're accusing me of getting too worked up about this man's
debauched lifestyle. I'm accusing you of knowing nothing about the people. Debauchery on a huge level. Yeah, well, you say you don't like debauchery.
I don't like debauchery.
You know, you used to like debauchery.
No, I didn't. I've never been into debauchery. I am not a debaucher, and I don't like debauchery.
You used to like it a lot more than you do now.
And I think people that pursue debauched lives actually have to pay for the debauchery that they pursue.
Yeah, well, like some kind of punishment from God. Is that what you mean?
You see,
sound like a fire and brimstone preacher.
You're trying to belittle the fact that I want to live a moral life and that I think Charlie Sheen's a disgusting man.
There's nothing moral about
your
life.
I do live a moral life.
No,
I live a very moral life.
There's nothing moral about
your life. I don't go around with the possibility of passing on transmittable diseases to other people who I want to have loose sex with on a regular basis. You think this is funny? Now,
I
don't think it's funny.
I think it's anything but funny. Loose sex.
What's loose sex?
Is that like full sex except with a bag or something?
No, you idiot. Loose sex means sex without any human emotion involved in it.
No, right.
It means for the sheer.
You've never had any of that, have you?
Have
you ever had any sex without emotion?
For the sheer physical fulfillment of exercising your libido with somebody else.
Are you telling me you've never had full sex without emotion?
I'm not telling you anything. And I'm not prepared to discuss with you my emotional state when I'm having physical sex. What I'm saying is that I think Charlie Sheen is a most disgusting individual.
Well, you've made that very clear.
Most disgusting individual.
But you don't want to come clean about your own habits.
Why don't we feel sorry for his victims, you know, the people who he slept with when he's had HIV?
This is what I'm trying to say to you. One, you don't know they're victims. Two, if you're going to sleep with Charlie Sheen, you're going to be pretty brave.
Well, if they're not his victims, then, are you telling
me... Why are you pointing at me like some deranged midget?
Every time he slept with one of these 5,000 people he slept with in the last 4 years, he says...
He hasn't slept with 5,000 women in the last 4 years. He has not slept with 5,000 women in the last 4 years.
So are you saying then that...
It's in the time, by the way.
That what he said is, in the last 4 years, before he's gone to bed with anybody, he said, by the way, I'm HIV positive.
Yeah, he has.
You all right with that?
Yeah, he has said that.
Well, in that case...
In that case, they should either have gone, well, in that case, I don't want to sleep with you, or they should have said, oh, OK, then I'll take the chance, which is what they did.
Hang on, in that case, did he explain exactly to the other person what HIV positive means?
I wasn't in the room.
Did he?
But once again, you're shooting off at the lip without knowing the full facts.
No, I'm not.
Never mind full sex.
No.
This is Talk Sport.
The BMW i3. It's not just an electric car. It's an electric car that drives like a BMW. Rentals from £299 per month. Discover more at bmw.co.uk/i3. £3,699 initial rental. 36-month hire agreement from BMW Financial Services. Subject to status and availability for new vehicles ordered before 31st of December 2015 and registered by 31st of March 2016. UK only, guarantees may be required. Mileage and other conditions apply when you return the vehicle.
You own this place?
Yes. And you are?
Winston Wolf, Direct Line. So you're a landlord, a property magnate, a wise guy.
I wouldn't go that far. It's just my wife's old flat.
But you have Direct Line landlord insurance with buildings cover, right? After all, if your boiler breaks down, they'll pay to repair or replace it.
No.
Oh, maybe not such a wise guy.
Boiler cover as standard with buildings cover. Can your landlord insurance do that? Search Direct Line Landlord. Excludes wear and tear. Underwritten by UK Insurance Limited.
Pneumonia strikes up to 1 in 100 of us every year. Don't let it be you. Vaccination can help protect you from the most common type of pneumonia. Speak to your pharmacist, doctor or nurse about pneumococcal pneumonia vaccination today. Or search Pneumonia Strikes. Sponsored by Pfizer.
Need meat? Got dry cleaning? Get it all at Clean Cuts, dry cleaners and butchers.
What? In business, being focused pays. Same goes for your bank. Allied Irish Bank GB is single-minded. We specialise in offering owner-managed businesses all the banking they need. So, for a bank as focused as you, visit aibgb.co.uk. Allied Irish Bank GB, the single-minded business bank. Allied Irish Bank GB is a trademark used under licence by AIB Group UK PLC, a wholly owned subsidiary of Allied Irish Banks PLC.
On DAB Digital Radio and 1089 and 1053 AM.
A terrific performance.
Turn of pace and eye for goal.
Shout about it.
Talk Sport.
Millions of people living as ho-ho-ho's. Yeah, but maybe it's not too late.
This is Talk Sport. We are the two mics. It is Ask Porky coming up a little bit later on. We can tell you that Winners and Losers is still open for voting. Mm-hmm. It's still 50-50, by the way. But we're now going to decide it, if necessary, on the retweets and the likes.
Yes.
Lord Rallo says this. He's tweeted at the two mics. Is old Porky aware that excessive bladderation is considered debauchery? And he says, hashtag crazed midget.
Well, if excessive bladderation leads to bad behaviour, then yes, I would agree with that. But
some people think excessive bladderation is indeed debauchery.
No, I'm not in that league at all.
No.
Controlled bladderation is my usual pursuit.
If you say so. Richard says, there's more criminal people in America than Charlie Sheen. Leave the man alone.
There's more people than what?
There's more criminal people in America than Charlie Sheen. Yeah. Leave the man alone.
Yeah, well, look, he's not a criminal. I said what he did for me was so debauched that it's unacceptable behaviour. Mm. And when you have HIV, which you can pass on to other people, you should then be slapped with a ban on having intercourse with other human beings.
Yeah.
Because you are clearly going to pass... There's clearly a very high risk of you passing that disease on, OK?
Yeah, sure.
So just like football fans can have orders slapped on them, banning them from football grounds when they misbehave, in my view, individuals who are carrying transmittable diseases like HIV should be ordered not... They should have an order placed on them prohibiting them from having physical sexual relations with other human beings. I'm sorry, but that's what you should do.
But this is not some anonymous guy that nobody's ever heard of walking around the streets picking up women at random and then, you know,
I think it is, isn't it?
Oh, no, it's Charlie Sheen. Yeah. Charlie Sheen, one of the most famous men in the world.
Yes.
Right? Everybody knows who Charlie Sheen is.
Right.
Everybody knows precisely what he's been up to over the course of years because he's talked about it.
Yes.
You know, his ex-wives have talked about it.
Mm-hmm.
You know, everybody knows that he's lived what you might describe as a very debauched life.
Yeah.
So if you're going to get into bed with Charlie Sheen, you know, you're going to be taking quite a risk in the first place.
Well, you say that, because you think the same way as him.
What do you mean I think the same way as him?
You think the same way as him.
What sort of calumny is that?
Well, what I'm saying
what are you getting
is at? You have a very liberal view to multiple...
Well, I don't make out some kind of fire and brimstone preacher.
Hang on. You have a very liberal view to multiple relationships with innumerable women. Okay?
Innumerable?
Yes.
Really?
Yes, you do.
I think that's incorrect.
You do. Whereas I have a much more
fixed... you don't have any relationships with women.
I have a much more fixed...
you don't have any.
I have a much more fixed moral compass about who I want to, you know, indulge in physical relationships with.
Rogerization with.
You
didn't answer the question in the last section, right? So let's ask you the question again.
Whereas you seem to have a very laissez-faire attitude to who you Rogerisation with, yes,
right.
definitely.
And you have to be in love with somebody you Rogerised.
I didn't say that at all. So what I said was you have to be extremely selective about, you know, with whom you mix these days in physical activity because of the dangers of transmittable diseases.
You sound like some kind of old fuddy-duddy. Here's one from Richard who says, did Porky mention only one third of his heart works to women during full sex?
That is a ridiculous question because it's quite obvious from my ability to cope, even though one third of my heart works, that would not be necessary.
Oh, okay. Mm. Matt says, also he's making assumptions about someone's life when he clearly knows nothing about it except what's been rumoured.
Mm. Well, it's not rumoured. What's he talking about?
Well, how about this from Sean?
This is a full confession from the guy.
Yeah, it is. But what you don't know is what he's. You said he's had sex with 5,000 women while he was HIV positive. That's not true.
That's a claim aired today.
No, the claim is that he has had sex with 5,000 women over his life,
right?
Not since he's had HIV.
Okay,
now,
I will correct that then. Sorry, it's probably since he had HIV just hundreds. Okay,
no, I don't think it is.
Probably just hundreds.
I think it's maybe dozens. Mm-hmm. Porky says Sean Charlie Sheen has said that he used condoms since he discovered he was HIV positive, with the exception of two encounters.
Oh, really?
So that's what it says.
And does he honestly believe in his naivety that just using a condom when you are carrying the HIV positive strain is enough to protect the person that you're having sex with from catching what you've got?
Well, generally speaking, yes, I think would be the answer to
generally
that.
Generally speaking,
yes.
Yes, might be the answer, but let's face it, you know, there are all sorts of problems with pursuing that theory where you know full well anything could go wrong.
Well, anything.
You know full well.
Well, things can go wrong.
Of course they can.
I mean, you know, life can go wrong. You can walk down the street and get hit by something falling off a building.
Yes.
You know, but if you're having sex with Charlie Sheen, as I said to you before, and you're willingly doing that, whether you're using a condom or not, you know, you need to seriously think about the risks that you're taking. Mm. How about this from Def? He says, I agree with Porky about Charlie Sheen, but taking the moral high ground is shaky. I think what his point is, you know, you're not really in any position to take the moral high ground.
Well, I'm not taking the moral high ground.
Of course
you are. Merely condemning what I consider to be the horrendously debauched attitude to life of a man who's in the public eye and therefore can often be accepted as untouchable in terms of his moral code because of his fame. Mm. Well, that's not good enough in my view.
Okay. Here's one with Sean, from Sean, who says, sleeping with married secretaries is debauchery, Porky.
Look, I'm not going to comment on that because we're talking here about a completely different issue. Mm. That is an issue of attitudes and relationships. This is one of dangerously putting other people dangerously at risk when you choose to have sex with them, and that's wrong.
Right. Well, I don't know what you get so worked up about. I've never seen you get so worked up
about
anything.
Well, you get worked up about these things.
Why should I get worked up about it? It's none of my business.
Because you like to defend him.
It's none of my business. I'm not defending
him. You like to defend him.
But it's none of my business what Charlie Sheen gets up to.
You like to defend him, and I'll tell you why.
It's nothing to do with me what Charlie Sheen gets up to.
I'll tell you why.
And neither has anything to do with you.
I tell you why you like to defend him, because at the back of your mind, you think to yourself, do you know what? One of these days, that could be me.
What?
I could be going down that route.
Going down what route?
That route,
of
mass debauchery in your relationships with the opposite sex. What are
mass
you laughing
debauchery.
At? I'm telling you.
No,
I'm telling you.
No, I can tell you now, I have no desire to have sex with four prostitutes and an entire baseball team. I would never have that, and I never will. How's that for you? That's a complete and utter denial.
I used to think you had the morals of an alley cat. In my view,
yeah.
Having heard you try to mount a defence of Charlie Sheen and his debauched lifestyle...
I'm just saying I think you're out of order by being so rant.
Alley Cat is putting it mildly, very, very mildly. Okay.
Well, I mean, you know, I didn't realise I was sitting next to some, you know, Archbishop of Rome next to me, you know, who's got some ridiculous idea that we're living in the, you know, Victorian era and women are very nice to look at, as you've just described.
Yes.
We're very happy that, you know, lots of nice-looking women are going to be at the Euros.
Yes.
But the idea that you'd have to have any kind of, you know, physical contact with them is somehow wrong.
No,
unless you're married.
I didn't say that.
Well, that's what you're coming across like.
No, I'm not coming across like that. I mean, how you can possibly mount any sort of defence?
I'm not mounting a defence.
What we're going to be reading in the next couple of days about the Charlie Sheen lifestyle.
I've never mounted a defence for him.
I think you will find we'll make you very unpopular with our audience who see now that your moral
compass
doesn't even exist.
I'm not interested in popularity.
Well, you should
Why should I be?
Popularity.
I'm interested only in speaking my mind about things that I believe in. And what I think you're doing, if you're trying to seek popularity, and presumably you're saying that's what you should be doing as well, is you're talking out of your backside, frankly, because you don't know what you're talking about.
That's a disgraceful thing to say. I'm not seeking popularity. I'm merely saying that we are here to represent the listeners and to reinforce their concerns
reinforce their concerns. How do you know what they are?
Well, I can tell you something. I'm a pretty good judge of character.
Oh, are you?
And I would say 98% of the audience, of the millions of people who listen to us, are much closer to the moral position I've taken than yours. Much closer.
That's what you believe. That's what's so funny.
Well, you now, say, and you laugh and you mock and all course. That. And yet, you know, it'd be easy for me to fall into the trap that you've fallen into. Oh, you know, who cares? Oh, it's Charlie Sheen. Oh, we can all have a debauched lifestyle.
You've seen the time, by the way.
No, I stand up for it.
I didn't say we can all have a debauched life.
I just think
you're a hypocrite.
I say no to debauchers.
No to debauchers.
Yeah.
Is that the signal? Now, coming up, we're going to say no to sleep deprivation as well, because something Porky suffers from. We're going to try and help him with it, because I think it might be affecting his brain. This is Talk Sport.
On DAB Digital Radio and 1089 and 1050. 53 a.m.
The pressure's on now.
Relieve the itch. Talks.
Well, we are the two mics. You can keep voting for another half an hour, just slightly under half an hour, till 3 o'clock on winners and losers, and we'll see how it all ends up. Now, I've got a couple of questions for you, Mr. Parry.
Yes.
Have you lost your sense of humour?
No.
Are jokes lost on you?
No.
Does alcohol go to your head?
No.
Do you forget key information?
No.
Do you sound like a robot?
No.
Do aches and pains seem worse?
No, why?
Well, I would say yes,
questions.
Yes, and yes. I mean, your last, rant about Charlie Sheen has proven to me that you've completely lost your sense of humour. And we're going to tell you why you've lost your sense of humour, and all these other things are true as well.
Well, you think it's a sense of humour to admire a man who's so debauched that he continues having sex when he's HIV positive.
So you can't move on. We're going to talk to Dr. Chris Winter now. He's a sleep specialist and neurologist from Charlottesville. He's going to tell you that you are suffering from sleep deprivation.
I don't think so.
Dr. Winter, very good morning to you.
Good morning to you. Thanks for having me back. I love the show.
Yeah, lovely to have you. Thank you very much indeed.
Now, good to hear from you,
Doc. Mr. Parry sits to my right here, and he claims that he sleeps less than probably 3 hours every single day before he comes into work all through the night. Now, I'm saying to him that this is starting to have some kind of long-term effect on his grumpiness, starting to have some kind of long-term effect on his memory, and probably on his general health. What can you say about somebody who has less than 3 hours of sleep a day?
I would probably say that they don't exist. That's what I would say.
Mm-hmm.
It's really hard to only get 3 hours of sleep every 24 hours. So basically be awake 21 hours and sleep 3. A lot of people who say that they're only getting 3 hours of sleep are actually getting more, but their brains simply don't perceive it.
Really? That's very odd.
Well, do you think he's actually sleeping more than he thinks, you mean?
I must virtually guarantee it. He would not be able to do the job he's doing as well as he does if he was only getting 3 hours of sleep a night. And believe me, there have been stretches when I was working in hospitals and running around sticking needles in people's necks where I was only getting an hour or two of sleep a night. And after a day or two, you're frankly hallucinating.
Yeah, that's what I think you're right about. Dr. Winter, we've got a terrible line here, so we're going to try and get you back on a slightly better line.
Thank you.
There are seven basic things that I saw in a piece, funnily enough, that came my way from one of what you would call one of your journals, right?
Exactly, one of my health journals.
Seven dangerous effects of long-term sleeping problems. Right. Junk food cravings, number one. You eat a lot of junk food.
No, I don't.
Sleep deprivation is bad for your skin.
No.
Bad for your memory.
Nothing wrong with my skin. Nothing wrong with my memory.
It's bad for your heart, says here.
Well, I mean, that's not my fault. The heart's already dodgy.
Yeah, well, the heart's being dodgy. It's not going to be helped by the fact you're not sleeping enough. Mm. It says you can get brain damage from long-term lack of sleep.
Do I look or sound like I've got brain damage?
Yeah, you do, actually.
No, I don't.
Yeah, you do. Sleep deprivation and death. Basically, people who sleep anywhere from 6.5 to 7.5 hours tend to outlive those who sleep for less.
Mm-hmm.
A study in the journal Sleep found men who got less than 6 hours of sleep a night were 4 times more likely to die over a 14-year period.
Isn't the famous story about Mrs. Thatcher that she had 4 hours sleep a night?
Yeah.
Isn't the famous...
And is she dead?
Is she dead? Well, she was a very good age when she did die. Well,
she's dead now.
She was the same age as the Queen when she died, and the Queen's still alive. Now, Churchill.
What do you mean she's the same age as the Queen when she died and the Queen's still alive?
Well, she was.
Well, how does that make your point?
It makes my point. Now, Winston Churchill only ever had 3 hours sleep a night.
And is he dead?
Well, of course he is, but he'd be 184 if he was still alive, you idiot.
Well, what age was he when he died?
He was 92.
Was he?
And he won the Second World War on 3 hours sleep a night. And in addition to that, he used to drink brandy and champagne for breakfast. Yeah. Oh, he didn't do badly, did he?
Well, he must have had a very, very strong constitution. Dr. Winter, let's try this line. How's that?
Oh, sorry about that. I think I lost you. It's a long connection.
Yeah, no, well, the line is still not very good. We're going to try and persist with it or try and get you another line. But, I mean, you know, you're proving my point because, you know, as the week goes in, right? You get more and more grumpy. You get less and less kind of...
No.
You forget things more regularly.
All right, well, you tell me this then. Tell me this, right. So, actually, I have quite a long night tonight because I do the show with you, which is always a great pleasure and all that. Then I go off to the Savoy and have some breakfast and all that kind of stuff. Oh, yeah. Okay. Then I come back because I enjoy a bit of banter with Mr. Brazil.
Yeah.
Al's not actually here tomorrow. It's Danny Kelly. But I enjoy a bit of banter with Danny. And I spend an hour or so going through the papers and that sort of thing.
I think Ray Parler's in as well.
And Ray's in. I enjoy a bit of banter with Ray, of course. And then I go home, and I usually get home around about 8:30, 9 o'clock or something like that.
Yeah.
And... then I have...
At which point you've been up all night?
Well, I don't even regard that as being
up all
night.
Well, yeah, but I mean, before you did this, right? Before you did this,
and
I've been doing it for much longer than you, you would normally be sleeping during a period of the night, right?
I
mean, you don't
stay
up...
Yeah, but not for much of the night,
But you don't stay up particularly late, do you?
No, I don't,
So you'd be in bed by, say, midnight or 11 or something?
Yes, I would,
And you would normally then sleep through maybe till about 4 or 5?
No, till about 3:30.
Till 3:30?
Yeah, till about 3:30.
So you'd only ever sleep till... Why get up at 3:30?
Because I am awake and want to get up. Now, what I'm saying is, if you let me finish, so tomorrow morning I get home about 9 o'clock.
Let you finish? All you do is finish.
No, hang on. The audience want to hear this. They want to hear this, right?
That, don't you?
Millions of people out there hanging on my words.
Well, we're trying to talk to Dr. Winter while he's got a decent
Well, we're
line.
Going to, but Dr. Winter needs to hear this as well. So if I get home after having been working all night... then at 9 o'clock tomorrow morning, I have some breakfast at home. I then feel in a position where I simply am not tired.
Yeah.
It would be a complete waste of time going into a room, drawing the curtains and trying to go to sleep because I don't feel I want to go to sleep. I usually end up doing a few hours' work and then usually go out at lunchtime to meet somebody or have things to do. I don't miss that.
So when will you sleep? When will you sleep then from getting home at 8:30 to coming back into work?
Probably that night.
Well, how long for?
I don't know, a couple of hours or something like
hours.
That. Yeah.
So, Dr. Winter, we're going to try third time lucky. How's this line?
Hopefully this will be a little bit better.
That is much better. Mm. I don't know why we didn't have that line the first time around. Mm. Now, you've just heard Mr. Parry describe his day, certainly tomorrow, where he's going to get home at 8:30 in the morning, having worked all night. Mm. He's going to stay up all day, and he might have a couple of hours sleep before he comes in to work all night again. Now, you can't tell me that's good for you.
Oh, it's definitely not good for you. In fact... you can't really name a part of your body that doesn't have a negative effect on.
But you see, Docker, I don't know what I'm supposed to do. If I don't
feel to sleep.
No, if I don't feel tired, and I don't feel tired when I get home tomorrow morning, I can't lie down because if I do, my head is very active, my brain's active, I'm lying there, I've got my eyes closed, I'm thinking, I don't know what I'm doing this for because I'm not going to go to sleep. So what is my alternative? What's the alternative?
Oh, I think that you should never try to sleep when you don't want to sleep.
That's what I mean.
I'll tell you what I would do, and it'd be kind of a fun experiment, and your listeners probably get a kick out of it, is buy something like a Fitbit or a Jawbone or one of those little fitness or activity trackers and wear it for a month.
Mm-hmm.
And what's interesting about that, we use this for some of the hockey teams and basketball teams that I work with, is you wear it 24 hours a day, and you wear it on your non-dominant arm. So if you're right-handed, you wear it on your left arm. And so when an individual sleeps, their arm is generally not moving.
Mm-hmm.
That makes a lot of sense. So at the end of the month, you can look and see where periods of sleep are happening. So if you truly can go an entire month sleeping about 2 to 3 hours a night and not feel any ill consequence to that, it would be sort of something that should be scientifically reported, because Tom Roth, who's this wonderful sleep researcher up in Detroit, Michigan, searched and searched people all over the place trying to find what's the smallest amount of sleep a human can buy with. And his conclusion was it's probably somewhere around 5 to 5.5 hours that a human can get on a consistent basis and feel no ill effects from, but those people were incredibly rare.
So what you're saying is
for you to be getting 3 hours of sleep and having no difficulty staying awake and talking and operating your car would be incredible.
Well, I mean, it wouldn't be right to say that he doesn't occasionally show symptoms of sleep deprivation, particularly on a Wednesday when you come in later, when I always have to ask you how much sleep you had, because you're sometimes more forgetful and you're sometimes less focused. That's not rubbish. But what you're saying, basically, Doctor, here, is that we could be dealing with some kind of medical miracle scenario. Wouldn't be the first time Porky was a medical miracle, because he was once sort of paraded in front of a load of German heart doctors.
That's right.
As a man who had suddenly suffered
acute heart failure.
Acute heart failure, but had recovered.
But recovered.
Yeah, well, that's, I mean, you know, there's a first for everything, but I'll tell you, every experience I've ever had with an individual giving these kinds of reports is that when you talk to their spouse or their partner, you kind of really evaluate their life. There are either pockets of hidden sleep, like on a Saturday when you don't work, you sleep for 12 hours to kind of make up for the debt, or there's what we call sleep state misperception, or something people call it twilight sleep, where you swear up and down you're just lying there on the couch watching TV, but you're actually asleep, and people don't—they're not aware of it.
Right. Well, so those are the two choices then. Well, so you're either lying, or you're a medical miracle.
Well, I'm not lying, and
you're not lying. They're not lying. They just don't perceive it. My wife falls asleep watching a television show, and she'll wake up 20 minutes later and doesn't think she's been asleep.
I don't. The other thing is, Doc, if you're sleep-deprived, normally speaking, you're in danger of falling asleep behind the wheel of a car
you're
driving.
You never get sleepy when you're driving?
Oh, absolutely.
I never get sleepy when I'm driving.
Everybody gets sleepy when they drive.
I don't get sleepy because I'm focused. I focus on everything around me to keep myself alert.
You're like the superhuman person is what you're basically trying to sell
us. I'm not saying that. What I'm saying is that for someone known... You see, I can't... What the Doc said there about, you know, track yourself and all that kind of stuff, how can I do that? I mean... If I don't
feel
like...
you're a big radio personality. Why don't you do a stunt to raise money for your favorite charity? And your job is going to be on the air broadcasting about all the great things you talk about for, you know, 24 hours, 48 hours, maybe 96 hours straight.
Well,
and you're allowed to take, you know, a 2-hour break.
He does that every week.
Yeah, exactly. I'm not sure it'd be a great challenge or a great test, to be honest. But anyway, I have to work it out my own way, and I don't know where the hours that I don't sleep go to. If you see what I mean,
absolutely.
I never feel like, oh, I had no sleep last night, therefore I need 12 hours tonight. That never happens to me. I can. And the other thing is, Doc, even if I was dog tired. And I go to sleep and lie down and I make all the circumstances right. You know, I close the curtains, the room's dark and all that. I will only sleep 3 hours. After that, I will wake up and I will be restless and I'll have to get up and do something else. I just can't, you know, I just don't like sleep.
Well, I understand
what you mean. Some people kind of view it as wasted time, but I'm telling you, there is an opportunity here for you to really... to kind of turn science on its head. And, you know, if you are that person, you know, I think I've heard sleep scientists describe, you know, the person who can get 1 or 2 hours of sleep and not only function. I mean, every doctor can function on an hour or two of sleep. We do it all the time. But to thrive like you are, you could very well be a medical miracle.
Well,
I've often said that.
It could be. That could be.
I've often said that.
I'm saying that's definitely an option. It's got to be.
Now,
it's gotta be.
Dr. Smith, because we took so much... Dr. Winter, sorry. We took so much time to get through to a decent phone line. We're out of time. But I've got a little quiz for Porky to come up, a question anyway for him coming up. And we'd love to have you back on. And maybe we'll try and do some kind of experiment to prove whether he is a medical miracle or just a bit forgetful that he's been sleeping more than at other times.
I think that sounds like a lot of fun. We can definitely do that. And next time, we'll use this line.
That's great. Thanks,
Dr. Chris Winter, sleep specialist and neurologist from Charlottesville.
Yeah, excellent.
On the dangers
good
of
to
sleep
have him
deprivation.
On the show.
Yeah, very good to have him on the show. I've got a great tweet here, actually, from Frazzle, who says, to sum up, the doc basically believes Porky is at it.
At it?
At it, yeah.
What do you mean?
Talking load of old cobblers.
No,
he
doesn't.
It wasn't very convincing.
Well, what do you mean it wasn't really good? I did just tell him the facts.
No, you said that you never feel sleepy while driving your car.
That's right.
Everybody feels sleepy driving a car some point.
I don't.
You've got some kind of affliction which doesn't allow you to admit to something that you might think makes you sound weak.
Mike, if I told you I felt sleepy driving a car, I would tell you. Why would I tell you I don't?
Well, because I don't understand why you would say that you never have ever felt sleepy while driving a car.
I didn't say that. I said I don't feel sleepy driving a car. I do remember in the past when I was a young reporter on the road, you were driving 1,000 miles a week. I do remember feeling, a bit groggy and all that. But it doesn't happen to me these days.
Okay.
That's all I'm saying.
And you say that you don't sleep any more than 2 or 3. I mean, this guy's basically saying you're a medical miracle if that's true.
Well, I can't help being a medical miracle, you know. That's just what I am.
Well, I've got a question to ask you when we come back, which will prove whether or not you're sleep deprived. This is Talk Sport.
An exhilarating drive is a given in the new BMW 320d ED+. But if you drive a company car, you might ask, what else is a given? First, There's exceptional fuel consumption from BMW Efficient Dynamics. Then there are CO2 emissions as low as 99 grams per kilometer, so you pay less benefit-in-kind tax. And there's more. BMW Business Navigation is now included as standard. Thrilling on the road, outstanding at the fuel pump. Request a test drive at your local BMW center. Figures may vary depending on driving style and conditions.
Asper Super Casino Westfield welcomes over 1.5 million visitors every year.
It's London's only super casino with over 150 slot machines.
A huge 400-seat poker room.
Two bars, free live music and a big sports screen.
We're membership free.
And we're open 24-7. Asper's Casino at Westfield Stratford.
So that's why they call it super.
Terms apply. Details at asperstratford.co.uk. Over 18s, play responsibly. Gambleaware.co.uk.
There is a reason why the Goodyear Efficient Grip Performance tyre is recommended by Auto Express in their 2015 product awards. With A rating for both wet grip and fuel efficiency in certain tyre sizes, you get performance and peace of mind as standard. Call in to your local QuickFit centre and ask about the award-winning Goodyear Efficient Grip Performance tyre. Goodyear, made to feel good.
Move or mow to save a bro. Make just 30 moves in 30 days this Movember and show your support for men's health. Movember, working in partnership with Prostate Cancer UK. Sign up now at movember.com.
Talk Sport.
He scores again!
The radio station with the extravagant lifestyle.
About 9 minutes left to vote in winners and losers as we close the voting down at 3 o'clock. Mm-hmm. And if it is all square, which it still is, by the way, it's going to be judged upon retweets and likes.
Yes.
So you retweet for Mike Parry, you like for me. Mm-hmm. And I'd have to say at the moment, you are slightly in the lead, Mr. Parry.
Thank you.
Calm down. Now,
vote Porky, now, vote often.
Now, this particular puzzle we've got here.
Yeah.
Right. Now, apparently, if you are sleep deprived and tired, you're more likely to get it right.
Right. Okay.
So if you get it wrong, you're more likely not to be sleep deprived.
Okay.
This is the puzzle. Two girls are born on the same day, month, and year to the same parents, but they aren't twins.
Say that again.
Why don't you say it again?
Say it again.
He's now covering his hands with his face, like a sleep-deprived person.
No, I'm concentrating. Yeah, go on.
Two girls are born on the same day, month and year, to the same parents, but they aren't twins.
Right.
How?
How?
How? You know, like the show How.
No, I know what you mean, yeah. How? That would be because. Are there only two parents?
What?
Are there only two parents?
Why are you asking supplementary questions?
Two parents, one
Why do you need to ask another question?
Well, it must be an HIV situation.
What?
Must be an HIV situation. HIV, sorry. I'm getting mixed up with Charlie Sheen. What's the thing called? Intro.
IVF.
Must be an IVF situation.
What do you mean an IVF situation?
Well, it must be. Because then a third party...
Well, how do you think IVF works?
Who is one of the parents... Well, you take an egg and you take sperm, you put them together.
Yeah.
Doesn't necessarily have to be the biological parents.
Right, so what you're saying is that these children could be born to the same parents...
Yes.
...on the same day, month and year.
Yes.
But they wouldn't be from the same egg.
That's right.
Really?
Yeah.
Okay, that's incorrect.
Right, what's the answer?
The answer is that they're triplets. They're two girls out of three, which is the obvious answer.
What, you mean there's three children born?
Yeah.
A stupid question.
You think it's a stupid question?
Yeah, right, go on.
Well, you got it wrong.
Well, sorry, is that the only question?
That's it.
Oh, it's the only question?
Yeah, that's it.
It's a stupid question.
Why is it a stupid question?
Because, you know, excuse me, that's not
it's
a question.
It's scientifically researched.
It wasn't a scientifically researched question, it was a stupid question. Right, I'll ask you one, you won't get this, okay?
All right, then.
Right, so what happens is a father and his son are in a car.
Are they?
And they
Does the father suffer from sleep deprivation?
He may do, because they have a crash and the father is killed.
All right.
The son is taken to hospital.
Yeah.
He is wheeled
into... Did he fall asleep at the wheel?
He is wheeled into the operating theatre, and as the operation to save his life is about to take place, the surgeon... says, I cannot operate on this boy, for he is my son.
Right.
Explain that.
Eh?
Explain that.
Explain what?
Well, I've just said to you.
What?
A boy is in a car with his father.
Yeah.
The car crashes and the father dies. Mm. The son is rushed to hospital.
Yeah.
He needs a life-saving operation. Mm. As he's wheeled into the theatre, the surgeon chosen to conduct the operation says, I cannot operate on this boy, for he is my son.
Right. Does she say it in a high voice?
What?
Does she say it in a high voice?
Who?
The surgeon.
What are you on about?
Is the surgeon female?
I've told you this one before. The surgeon is his mother.
Yeah, I know.
Yeah, and I've told you this one before.
No, you haven't told me before.
I have told you that before. Of course I have.
You just don't like the fact that I got it right.
Rubbish. I told you
that
before.
Look at the state of you.
I told you that months ago, but I thought you were too thick to have remembered.
No, I'm the one that doesn't forget things.
Yeah.
You're the one that forgets what you said
yesterday. So you admit I told... Goodness gracious me. I mean,
the point is, you know, you've just accused me of admitting to hearing a story before, which I never heard.
Of course you did.
I didn't.
Of course you did. I've told you that story.
It's very obvious.
It's not obvious.
There's only two parents. One of them has to be the mother.
It's not obvious at all. Nobody's ever got that one before because everybody assumes.
Nobody's ever got that one before.
No, it's because
the only people you tell it to are thick.
No,
right? Is that it?
No, it's a test. It's a test to demonstrate the innate sexism within our society that you think everybody.
Yeah, well, I'm not sexist.
Everybody in an important job is a man.
No, that's what you think.
No, I don't.
Yes, you do.
You've previously
said many times that you think that, you know, most women that you see are probably not working in very high-powered jobs.
I've never said that.
You've always questioned Dr. Eva Canero, that she wasn't a real doctor because you really didn't understand how there could be a female doctor running Chelsea.
Utter rubbish.
You've always
she was
questioned
not the
that.
Sort of doctor that qualifies from King's College London and could become my local GP. That's all I said. That's all I said.
Now, how about this from Jack in Essex?
Right.
Nikola Tesla, one of the greatest minds of all time, claimed to only sleep for 2 to 3 hours every night. People did back him up in this statement, and look at everything he accomplished during his life.
There you go.
Maybe there are exceptions to this rule.
Thank you.
Well, except that, again, as the doctor said, people may claim to only sleep for 3 hours.
Mm.
People may claim to do all sorts of things, but the fact is, they probably don't.
Well, hang on. You're the one who initiated this investigation into how long I sleep, because you don't think I sleep long enough. Now you're accusing me of making it up. I don't make it up because I never tell you how much I sleep or don't sleep. You just assume it all.
No, you told the doctor you don't sleep more than 2 or 3 hours a day.
I don't.
So he said, basically, that
means... Actually, I didn't say. I said I don't sleep more than 2 or 3 hours at a time.
OK, so would you like to reaffirm how many hours you sleep then?
Well, never more than 5.
So now it's 5?
No. I can sleep for 2.5 to 3 hours, get up, move around, then say, oh, then go back to bed. But if I go back to bed, it'll be 30 minutes.
Mm.
So 3.5.
So first it was 2.5, now it's 3.5, then it was 5. I mean, make up your mind.
No, it's about... It depends on what I've been doing.
I'm now beginning to believe the doctor, because the doctor basically said that you probably sleep more than you think.
Yeah.
And you now have just admitted that.
Well, when am I supposed to be sleeping when I don't know... I mean, how can people sleep if they don't know they're sleeping? That's idiotic.
Well, I don't know how you manage that.
Idiotic.
Here's one from Fifi, who says, Mike and Mike, great as always. Do you know some people with dicky hearts are frightened to sleep because they think they might not wake up?
No, that's rubbish. No, I don't fear that at all.
Then here's one. This is a good one. Yeah. After the doctor said that you should try to stay on air
this
for
will
as
be
long
a cruel
as possible.
One. This will be a cruel one.
The last
one.
DJ that tried to stay awake on air in America in the 60s for hours and hours and hours on end spent the rest of his life in and out of mental institutions.
Really? Mm. Yeah, isn't that funny? You know?
Craig in Eastbourne says, what a revelation, Parry's telling porkies. Nobody believes you.
That is utter rubbish.
Nobody believes you.
It's utter rubbish. I'm not telling any porkies at all. In fact, I never even wanted to get onto the subject of how long I sleep. You've got an obsession about it, not me.
No, because I'm worried about you.
I just try to take as much sleep as I can.
I'm genuinely worried about you.
I don't think you're genuinely worried about you. Once again, you find it a platform from which you can launch, you know, a mischievous and ridiculous assault on my lifestyle and on my character, and I'm beginning to find it rather tiring.
Are you?
And rather tiresome.
Well, you need
actually.
To get more sleep.
Sorry?
You need to get more sleep.
Oh, dear.
How about this one from Nom de Plume?
Go round in circles.
Nom de Plume in Camden, who says, evening, MG, when did Porky start writing columns for the Women's Institute Weekly? Whatever Charlie Sheen did with consenting adults is entirely his and their business alone. So there we are.
Oh, yeah, but if everybody in the world acted like that, we'd all now be in a fevered state of mass disease...
Mass debaucherisation.
Never mind debaucherisation. We'd have mass communicable diseases rife around the world.
Is that right?
Yes.
Excellent.
On top of all the diseases we've already got, which arrive around the world.
Talk Sport on DAB Digital Radio and 1089 and 1053 AM.
Freedom for sport.
Can we kick it? Yes, we can. Talk Sport.
This is Talk Sport. We are the Two Mics. There will be a podcast coming out a little bit later on today, of course. And all day, it's been a real cliffhanger on the old winners and losers, because the new system has been... It was around about lunchtime, right, that we drew level. There was only about 2% in it during the morning. Mm-hmm. And sometimes it was in your favour, sometimes
okay,
mine.
OK, let's get to the result. Let's get to the result.
Calm down. The end result is that the actual voting itself has got a record number of voters. Can you believe? 1,798 votes cast.
Brilliant.
Which is the biggest ever.
It used to be a matter of 150,
Well, it used to be sort of 300 between us, or 400 between us, or maybe 500 between us. But, you know, last week it was 1,300. This week, 1,798.
Unbelievable.
Incredible. And it still ends up 50-50, right?
Yes.
So, as we said, we would agree on the retweet and favourite scenario.
Indeed.
And it was retweet for you.
Yes.
And it was favourite for me.
Yes.
And you have 110 retweets to your name.
Yes.
I have 111.
No, don't be ridiculous.
It's true.
Don't be
ridiculous.
It's
all there in black and white.
You told me 10 minutes ago I was leading.
You were leading. You were leading by about 4. And now suddenly I've won it by 1.
No, that can't be true.
It's true.
I want to see the results.
Well, I'll show you. I took a picture of what it was doing at midnight, right, which I will now show you.
Mm.
And you'll be able to see very, very clearly why I've actually won. Because there it is there in black and white. It's actually 108, 110. If you look at the top of the screen, you'll see that it's midnight. You'll see that it's 3 in the morning, rather.
Mm-hmm.
See that?
Mm-hmm.
And then you'll see that it is 100...
It says 258.
What?
258.
No, it doesn't. Here, give it to me.
It says today 258.
No.
So you've gerrymandered it.
No, it doesn't say 258.
Well, it says 258. Today, 258.
All right, that's the wrong one then.
Oh, there we go. Didn't like that result. That's the wrong one, eh?
So that's the one at 3 o'clock there.
Oh, I see. No,
No, I didn't change it. I took one at 2:58 because I thought I'll show what it was 2 minutes before, and I'll show what it was at 3. And at 3, what does it say on the retweets and the likes?
You said 110, 111.
Yeah.
This is 109, 110.
Well, 109, 110.
So doesn't
matter.
You've got
it's
that wrong
more.
As well.
Well, it's one more, isn't it? So you've lost.
No, I don't agree.
What do you mean you don't agree?
I don't agree. The margin of error is 1% in all these things, and therefore that's within the margin of error. Therefore, it's a draw.
Lost. No, it's not a
it's
draw.
It's a draw.
No, you've lost.
It says 50-50 in the main vote.
No.
And 110, 119 in the supplementary vote.
So
it's got to be a draw.
19. Well, no, it's not.
In any election...
It's now 10-3.
In any election or any ballot, that would...
No, in any election or any ballot, whoever gets the most votes wins.
No,
right?
That would be a draw. Or we demand a recount. But, I mean,
well,
it can't possibly...
Well, you can have as many recounts as you like. You've
it
lost.
It can't possibly have gone that way.
It could have gone either way. If you had won it, I would have been quite happy for you. Why can't you just be happy for me?
Hey? No, this is not... It's not. Something's
it's
gone completely wrong here.
Well, it's 10-3.
How come I was leading 10 minutes ago, but I'm not now?
Well, because a bunch of people voted in the final 2 minutes, obviously.
They couldn't have done, because I gave the call out, vote Porky, vote often.
Yeah, but
they can't have gone...
Yeah, but they can't vote more
than once.
Can't
have gone into reverse on that one.
They can't vote more than once.
Well, I'm sorry, I'm not having this. I'm not having it. Right, now then, we should talk to something which is interesting and which the audience want to talk about, OK?
Not how do you know what they want to talk about?
Well, because I know these things. Not this ridiculous, gerrymandered, cobbled up...
I'm sorry you're so upset.
Half, how many cups of coffee do you drink a day?
Not that many, actually.
Talking about brain stuff and all that kind of stuff.
I mean, I used to drink more coffee when I worked during the day, because I'm not a big coffee drinker. When I come in at night, I drink mostly water, and I usually have maybe 2 cups of tea.
If you drink 5 cups of coffee a day, you live longer. That's apparently why Americans live longer than we do.
But they don't, do they?
Well, apparently they do,
Really? On what basis is that, then?
What?
Their average life cycle is longer than ours.
Yeah, apparently,
I don't believe that.
But, I mean, you know as well as I do, you can't get a cup of tea in America anyway.
No, it's not very easy, no.
Well, it's not very easy.
You can in some places,
not easy at all.
Coffee is definitely the drink of choice.
Yeah, every office you go into, there's a percolator there, isn't there, with a big jug of coffee on it, and everybody drinks coffee all day long. That's probably why they got brown tea as well.
Or they drink chai, which is the kind of, the sort of trendy thing to drink. Chai.
Chai? What's chai?
Yeah, it's a sort of a hot drink that's supposed to be good for you, sort of herbal.
Well, is it like a Chinese thing?
It's a sort of herbal thing,
So it's called chai.
Chai.
But The problem with coffee is, I have two problems with coffee. Mm. One, it tastes very bitter in the mouth to me, even though I put loads of sugar in it.
Do you not drink, like, cappuccino or anything like that, or latte?
Well, I do sometimes, but I've got a cappuccino machine, so I don't make it myself.
No.
And I don't trust anybody else to make
it. No, but, I mean, if you were out and about, would you not go to one of these many now coffee shops?
Yeah, I might do, but the problem with cappuccino is it's mostly like drinking froth.
It is, yeah.
You drink
froth.
In fact,
I stopped going to one of the... I'm not going to name which one it was, but one of those coffee places.
Right.
Because it got... I detected that the coffee actually got weaker.
Yeah.
And what they wanted you to do was put an extra shot in it so you can taste it. But you're right. Yeah. It's like drinking a frothy milk.
Yeah, of course it is. Yeah, it's no good at all. Tea, on the other hand, is, as far as I'm concerned, a proven stimulant for the whole of your bodily system.
Yeah.
And do you know why?
Because it's got caffeine in it.
Well, it hasn't got as much caffeine as coffee.
It's got more caffeine than coffee.
No, it hasn't.
It has.
No, rubbish.
That's not rubbish.
No, it's rubbish. But
no, that's true.
The reason why is that we first discovered tea in India, and tea from India has exactly the same effect on your constitution as Indian curry, i.e. the spices and the flavours in it are identical, and therefore very stimulatory.
Maybe it doesn't taste like curry.
Eh?
It doesn't taste like curry.
Of course it doesn't taste like curry, you idiot.
You said the flavours are identical.
No. The constituents of the spices are identical. That's what I meant.
What spices are in tea, then?
Tea leaves.
Tea leaves?
Yeah.
And how is that similar to garam masala, for example?
To what?
Garam masala. It's an Indian spice.
Garam masala?
Yeah, or turmeric.
I don't know what garam masala and turmeric are.
You just said the spices are identical.
I'm talking about things like biryani.
Yeah.
Yeah?
Biryani spice.
Yeah.
Well, was that in tea?
Well, there's elements of it in tea.
Elements?
And do you know why?
Well, when I make a biryani...
Because it's grown in the same soil...
Well, when I make
on
a biryani...
On the same Indian hills as the biryani plant.
Really?
Yeah.
That's unusual, actually, because a biryani plant is not really anything that exists, and a biryani is not a Ceylonese-type dish. And most of the tea...
I didn't say it came from Ceylon, I said it came from India.
Well, most of the tea we get comes from Sri Lanka.
Oh, and that's not true. Not true. Mm. Indian tea. I drink Indian tea.
I don't think you got this right.
I have got it right. Mm. I have. Anyway, look, I don't know why you're talking about
that. You
know,
when I used to first do the weekend overnight show,
yes,
we used to have a Kona coffee machine here, you know, where you get sort of the big glass flask full of coffee.
A Kona?
Well, it was called Kona. Why do you think that's funny?
Oh, I've never heard of it.
You've never heard of Kona coffee?
No, it sounds to me like a Scandinavian pint.
No, you're thinking of Skoll, aren't you?
No, Kona. I thought
or Krona, which is a Scandinavian currency.
Yeah, well, no. Krona's also a beer, isn't it?
A Krona?
Yeah, you can get a Krona in a bottle. Of course you can.
A Corona with Mexican beer.
Yeah, a Corona, that's it.
Yeah,
that's
it's not Krona.
About. Well, it's people of loose explanatory mouthful facility
sometimes,
call it Corona.
Yeah, sometimes they do.
Yeah.
Anyway, I'm sorry this is a boring story because it's about me, but they used to have this glass thing and I'd fill it up with coffee. It's like filter coffee, right?
Yes.
And I would drink a whole thing of that during the course of the five-hour show that I did.
Okay, yeah.
And I would get home and I'd wonder why I couldn't go to sleep.
No,
and
exactly.
I'd literally be, you know, sitting bolt upright in bed till about midday.
Oh, I couldn't drink that much coffee.
No, I know.
Coffee to me is the bitter aftertaste of coffee. I can drink one coffee a day and that's about it. And after that, I can drink a few cups of tea. One thing I can't stand, though, I can't stand cold tea.
Hmm.
I don't know why. My tea's got to be hot.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? It's got to be, like, palate-burning for it to have any effect on me whatsoever.
Really?
Yeah.
Yeah. Now, one of your idiotic followers has put this up. He's called himself Porchester Rovers on Twitter, right?
Yeah.
It says, fact, you can't even report final scores. And he's got a score down here of 118 retweets to 112 likes. The only problem is that the time that he's timed it at is 3:09, 9 minutes after the poll was closed.
But the votes were still coming in.
Doesn't matter.
The votes were still coming in.
Well, the votes will come in for another 20 minutes. That's not the point.
I mean,
the poll was closed at 3 o'clock.
Damn disgrace, I tell you, the whole thing.
It's not a disgrace. I don't understand why you're such a bad loser.
I'm not a bad loser. I just don't like being cheated. Mm. The whole damn thing is a disgrace. Honestly, it really is.
Yeah, well, it's
10
to
3
now.
I don't know why we go on with this because, you know, every week. Do you know what you are?
You were so happy about this because you thought you were going to win it.
Do you know what you are? You're like a drugs cheat who always tries to keep one step ahead.
Not true.
One step ahead of the drug testers. And I'm the drug tester and I'm trying to live life by my moral code and my moral compass, and you are always dodging around it, trying to seek an advantage. And, I mean, it's not that I'm not smarter than the average bear. I could outmaneuver you and outwit you if I wanted to, but I don't want to cheat.
Yeah, I know you don't want to cheat because it's against your better values, isn't
it? I've got that one. It's from a guy called Anonymous. I've just voted dead on 3 a.m. to make it 111 to 100. Oh, it's the guy who voted for you. Well, I tell you what, mate, you are a jerk.
That's very harsh. This is Talk Sport. We are the Two Bikes.
We took the all-new Mitsubishi L200 Series 5 across the globe for 18 days and 4,267 miles. We conquered the Sahara Desert and the Atlas Mountains to show the world the most manoeuvrable, economic, efficient, safest and capable pickup we've ever made. The Mitsubishi L200 Series 5, showing the world how it's done. Search Mitsubishi L200 and test the best.
Welcome to Sounds Fantastic. Now, can you identify this sound? That was a hippopotamus accidentally tripping over a harpsichord. Now, what about this sound?
Go compare.
Yeah, that's the sound that's already helped millions of people save money on their car insurance.
He's where you go to insure your motor. Nothing quite compares to Go Compare.
Sounds fantastic.
The big red building on Golders Green Road.
The big pre-Christmas sale is now on at the big red building in Golders Green Road. Beautifully tailored men's suits from only $79.95. Plus big reductions on dinner suits, cashmere and wool overcoats, jackets and trousers. At Gold's Factory Outlet, 110 to 114 Golders Green Road. Open all week Sunday to Thursday 10 to 6, half day Friday, close Saturday. Open Christmas Day, Boxing Day and Bank Holiday.
The big red building on Golders Green Road.
Are you looking after someone who's 65 or over? Maybe a friend, a neighbour or an elderly relative? Cold weather can be seriously bad for their health, but there are things you can do to help them stay well this winter. Make sure they get their flu jab. Help get the medicines in before it gets too cold or before the holidays. And make sure they keep warm. Their home should be at least 18 degrees C, 65 Fahrenheit. NHS, we're here to help you stay well this winter.
On DAB Digital Radio and 1089 and 1053 AM.
He smashed it into the back of the net.
Football for the people.
Come on, give us a go.
Talk Sport.
That must bring a smile to your face, hearing that piece of music.
It does, rather. Who's the singer of that song? I know Kelly McGillis was the great actress in that film. She never really made another film again.
Takes my breath away. I don't know, was it Kim Carnes or somebody like that? No, it was Berlin, yeah, the band called Berlin.
Berlin?
Yeah.
Okay, yeah. Well, who was the lead singer of Berlin?
I've no idea, absolutely no idea.
She had a lovely voice, didn't she?
She did. But I can't name anything else that they ever did.
That was an amazing song. But I think the music score for Top Gun was the best I've ever heard. It was just brilliant. The best I ever heard was Saturday Night Fever.
Yeah.
In the disco era, of course, when it was appropriate.
Yeah.
But nevertheless, it made a good film an absolute classic as that film score. Why are you playing me that?
Well, because they're talking about a sequel being made. It's slightly mysterious because Kilmer.
Top Gun 2.
Yeah, Top Gun 2. Now, I was going to ask you.
They very rarely
because,
work, do they?
Yeah, they don't. And also, I can't remember how Top Gun ends, right?
Yeah.
But presumably,
you know.
Well, that's what I thought I'd ask you. So how could they take it on? I mean, how does it end?
Well, it ends because they're sent to Miramar, right? Old Goose and Maverick,
right?
But Goose dies,
and is that Val Kilmer?
No, he's Iceman.
Ah, okay.
Val Kilmer is Iceman.
All right, okay.
And he's the guy, he's the big threat to Maverick becoming the top guy.
Maverick is Tom Cruise.
And
who's the guy that dies?
That's Goose, who is his...
Who played him, then?
His navigator. Oh, I don't know, some guy with a rubbery face, some tall fella. No, seriously, I've never seen him in any film ever since.
All right.
But what happened is they ejected from the plane.
Yeah.
And old Goose sort of must have bashed his head on the canopy or something.
Or the parachute didn't open or something.
No, the parachute opened, but I think he was like killed. Anyway, they got down, and then Tom Cruise wouldn't let go of his mate, even though his mate was dead. And it was a great scene where these US Navy scuba divers jump out of a helicopter and swim over to him and say, "You got to let him go, sir. You got to let him go." You know, this kind of stuff.
Because he wants to bring him home, but he's too late.
Yeah, he's too late. He's dead. And then there's an inquiry, and Maverick is not blamed at all. It said that the plane just got into a vortex, you know, like a wind vortex, which spun it round and then had to eject and all that. But anyway, point of the story is, at the end, what happens at the very end is that Iceman, who's Val Kilmer, who went on to play Batman, of course, right? And also played...
And Jim Morrison.
Eh?
He played Jim Morrison as well.
Did he play Jim Morrison? Yeah. Played a cowboy as well, didn't he?
Probably.
Yeah, somebody like Doc Holliday or somebody.
He's been in a lot of movies.
He has, yeah. He wins the award as the Top Gun.
Mm.
And so, old Tom Cruise says, "Yeah, okay, well done," and all that kind of stuff. And then the film just ends.
Right. So they could take it on. It could be the second adventures of Iceman and whatever.
Yeah, it could do. Could do, definitely. But Kelly McGillis wouldn't play in it again because she was very beautiful in that film. But that's like 30 years ago
Well, she wouldn't necessarily have to be in it. But the reason that people have got excited is because Val Kilmer wrote on Facebook these words: "I just got offered Top Gun 2. Not often you get to say yes without reading the script. Mm. It's starring Gene Hackman. Yes. The director is Francis Coppola. Yes. Jerry Bruckheimer and Tom Cruise. Yes.
Really?
We would all miss Tony Scott, one of the kindest gentlemen I've ever met in the film business, but let's fire up some fighter jets again." Because Tony Scott, of course, was the director.
Oh, was he?
Yeah.
And has that been confirmed, then?
Well, it hasn't, no, because he then later came out and said, basically, he wasn't actually correct in saying that Coppola and Hackman would be returning to a Top Gun sequel. But he's apparently...
Well, Gene Hackman wasn't in the first one.
Well, whatever.
Yeah.
But he's saying that he was maybe jumping the gun there. Maybe they got onto him and said, "Hang on a second, we haven't agreed to do this." But there's definitely a script in the works, and Val Kilmer's definitely keen on doing it.
Yes.
So no,
I wonder how it would work this time. You see...
Are you sure that's how it ends?
Yeah, of course I'm sure how it ends. Why?
Well, I just wondered, because, I mean, I don't remember any of that.
Well, did you see the film?
Yeah, I've seen the film, yeah.
I've not seen it as many times as you have. I've seen it about 20 times.
Wasn't there, like, a big sort of, shoot-up at the end? Like
yes, there was, yeah, but that was the final test to run up the points for Top Gun.
Uh-huh.
And Val Kilmer came out on top.
Right.
Yeah. I mean, the opening sequence where he has to bring his buddy down,
no.
you know.
Yeah. I don't really, because I don't know the film very well. This is why I'm asking you, because you're supposed to be the expert in Top Gun.
It's
your favourite film.
But the thing is, it's an aircraft carrier with a load of aeroplanes on top.
Yeah.
And as it opens, it says Indian Ocean, present day.
Right.
Which is very clever, really, because a US aircraft carrier today looks exactly the same as a US aircraft carrier 30 years ago.
Mm.
They've not changed at all.
Haven't they?
No.
They haven't got bigger.
They
have. Because that one that came to Portsmouth, you remember, it was too big to come into
the harbour.
Theodore
Roosevelt. Yeah, but they've always been too big. They've always been too expensive.
Well, no, but that was the biggest one ever made.
Well, it is, but it wasn't that much bigger than the previous ones,
believe
me. Well, it must
have been quite a bit bigger.
It had 90 aircraft on it, which is quite amazing, isn't it? Considering that when we get an aircraft carrier that pulls into Portsmouth Harbour, it will have precisely no aircraft on the deck.
On account of we can't afford any.
We haven't got any aircraft. Yeah. I know, it's just bizarre.
Dave says Goose was played by Anthony Edwards, who went on to play a doctor in ER.
Oh,
did he? George Clooney, yeah.
Oh, okay. Well, I mean, that might be the case. I never saw him in a film again. That's the point I'm making. But I don't think you should make Top Gun 2. I think Top Gun, the original, was just so brilliant. That it'd be like making Mary Poppins 2 or Sound of Music 2.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
It'd be more like the best thing to do would be to remake the movie, wouldn't it? And just put a completely new cast in it and just remake Top Gun. Because, that's what they're
doing
a lot.
That.
Well, they're remaking Mary Poppins, I think, aren't they?
Are they? I didn't know
I think so. They've remade Cinderella. I mean, they've remade all sorts of films.
I'm not sure about that. Because there maybe are things in this modern day and age which you couldn't put into the film, which were in it then.
Mm.
Like Tom Cruise speeding around everywhere and breaking the speed limit on a motorbike.
Yeah.
Even though he's a fighter pilot, you know what I mean?
Right.
Love the thrill of speed, I suppose, and all that kind of stuff. You know
what
I mean?
Exactly.
Yeah, absolutely.
Mm.
And that famous scene where he sang... "You never close your eyes anymore."
That wasn't Top Gun.
That was Top Gun.
Really?
Yeah. Yeah, what happens is they go to Miramar.
See, I've only seen it once and I didn't think very much of
it. Right,
because, I don't even know why we're talking about it to this extent.
Because you brought it up with Val Kilmer.
Well, yeah, I know, but it's not
that
great of a film, though, is it?
No, they go to Miramar, Tom Cruise and Goose. Maverick and Goose.
Yeah.
And that's where they meet Kelly McGillis. And she says, what's your name? And he says, Maverick. And she says, didn't your mother like you?
Yeah.
And this is because he's interjected when she's getting bothered by other aviators.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, what is your
job? Flyboys.
Yeah, what's your job, sailor? No, no, ma'am, I'm not a sailor, I'm an aviator.
Right.
An aviator? What does that do? I fly aeroplanes, you know, and this kind of stuff.
Mm.
And then he moves in to rescue her from the attentions of, I think, you know, it's not Val Kilmer, it's one of the other pilots, you know. And then he picks up the microphone, you know, and starts singing, you never close your eyes anymore when your lips meet mine.
When I kiss your lips.
That's right, when I kiss your lips. There's no tenderness.
You don't have to sing the whole
anymore.
Thing.
You know, and all that kind of stuff.
I've got a couple of tweets here from a couple of people.
Okay.
Marcus says, how could this be your favourite movie and you say that's how it ends? They went on a big mission at the end. And Russ says, Anthony Edwards played Goose, famous from ER, and Porky, there was a dogfight with the Russian MiGs at the end.
No, there wasn't.
Well, that's what two people are saying.
No. They don't understand the film. They never fought any MiGs. The MiGs were American planes. It was all an exercise. It was an exercise over Miramar. They didn't fight the Russians.
Are
because
you sure?
I'm absolutely certain.
Are you sure you saw it all the way to the end?
Of course I saw it all the way to the end.
How many times have you seen it?
20 times.
20 times?
Yeah, yeah.
And you're sure that's the ending?
I'm certain it's the ending.
Dave says Maverick went back to Top Gun to be an instructor so Top Gun 2 could carry on from there.
No, he didn't. He didn't because he didn't win the Top Gun. It was Iceman who went back as the instructor because only the guy who wins, because they were instructed by a former Top Gun pilot who won the coveted, you know,
well, there's
shield.
A lot of this coming in. Paul says Top Gun ends in a bar after fight with Russian MiGs.
No, there were no fight with Russian MiGs. Don't they understand? The Russian MiGs were US airplanes with Russian markings on them to simulate
so
a battle.
They were just pretend Russian MiGs.
Of course they were. Nobody got shot down. No planes got blown up or shot down or anything.
How did Goose die then?
Goose died when the plane got out of control, spun round, they had to eject.
He didn't get shot.
He didn't get shot at all. No, nobody got shot. In fact, my complaint about the film has always been that what they should have done is it was round about the time that the Americans tried to bomb me in Libya.
All right.
So my claim is.
Maybe they were just pretending.
No, I've written to people about this all the time saying, why didn't you end with a simulated
what do you mean
bombing?
You've written to people.
Hang on. To film
who?
Critics. Film critics. Oh. With a simulated bombing run over Libya to replicate what actually happened instead of a pretend fight over the Mojave Desert, which is exactly what happened.
Oh, okay.
They never fought the Russians.
How did they get an aircraft carrier to the Mojave Desert?
No. It was they came off the aircraft carrier to be sent to Miramar, which is a land-based U.S. Air Force base in California, to improve their fighting skills.
Oh, I see.
Yes.
Blimey.
Yeah,
I had
no idea.
Anyway, that's the Top Gun 2 conversation.
Indeed.
Sorted. Coming
on DAB, digital radio, and 1089 and 1053 AM, the enduring home of football.
Right, so that music signals, of course, the Ask Porky section that we do every Tuesday night going into Wednesday. We have started now posting on Facebook on the Two Mics page, so if you want to go there, you can join.
Yeah.
We've got an awful lot of questions that have come in on Facebook.
Yeah.
Loads on Twitter as well, which have come in at the Two Mics.
Mm-hmm.
Now, here's one. Starting off, because if you can do what you normally do, which is get through as many of them as possible, as quickly as possible. So one from Stephen, who says, lights are left on constantly in our house. It's like Blackpool Illuminations. It's driving me mad. What can I do, Porky?
Say that again.
He says, the lights are left on constantly in our house. It's like Blackpool Illuminations. Yeah. It's driving me mad.
Yeah.
What can I do?
Switch them off.
Well, presumably he tries to, but there's other people who keep switching them on.
Well, I mean, I don't understand this. This guy must live in a house where they all work shifts or something. Does that mean
he must live in a house with kids in it and families and all the rest
of
it?
Well, if I were you, you've got two choices. Either start asserting your authority and turn them off and show them who's boss, or get yourself a den, like they have in American homes, where you can go in there, lock the door, and have some of your own time to yourself. It's called self-time, OK?
Well, how's that turn the lights off, though?
Well, you don't have any lights in your den, or you have lights in your
just
den.
Lie there in the dark.
No, you have lights in your den with an internal switch. You either switch the light on or you switch it off. But if your kids are running around giving you grief and not allowing you to get the recuperation and rest you need, how can you be an earning father responsible for your children?
Mm.
Assert your authority, man. You sound to me like you're a cushion that's been booted around in your own house.
Don't
be a cushion.
All right, here's one from Richard. Mm. Does the Portmeister believe in ghosts? This was on Facebook.
Does the poor mice believe in ghosts? Ghosts do not exist, full stop.
Hmm.
So there's no point going on that question and answer. Ghosts do not exist, OK?
Well, that's
what
a straight no, isn't it?
Hey?
That's a straight no, then.
Yeah, what does exist is the re-emergence of a spirit in certain circumstances where all the factors have to come together. But you don't... And by the way, why are people afraid of ghosts? Ghosts have got no substance.
We haven't got time for that.
Why are people afraid of ghosts?
More questions.
No.
Ghosts
don't exist. Don't exist.
Philip says, Porky, give three reasons why you deserve a knighthood and give three reasons why old MG does not. And that's on Facebook as well.
Well, I have a superior moral compass. I'm also a leader of men, where I lead, people follow. And the third reason is I think in a manner which improves the economy of this country, OK? The reason why old MG would never, ever be honoured by the state is, one, morals are not a cat. Two, a moral compass which is so badly flawed that it's broken to the extent where it doesn't move around anymore.
That's the same reason.
No, it's not. No, they're two totally different.
Really?
And the third one...
Morals of an alley cat and no moral compass.
Yes, absolutely. And yes, exactly.
Like an alley cat without a moral compass.
Exactly. Yeah. And the third one is the fact that he contributes nothing to the improvement of the economy in this country, going around buying
That's
bottles...
That's not true.
Going around and buying bottles
of... buying champagne not contribute?
Because champagne is imported from France therefore you're contributing nothing to the internal economy of this country. Next question, please.
I think you're wrong about that. Ashley says, Christmas is coming and money is tight. What cheap gift should I get my fiancé for Christmas that she will love?
If I were you, I'd get her some paste jewellery, because that's always a good one. Because a woman who receives a gift, which is shiny and sparkly, will often say, oh, it's beautiful, without knowing the true worth of it. And
a DVD from the two mics.
A DVD from the two mics is a very good idea because that will provide you with an evening in which you can, you know, use the famous expression, oh, thought we'd stay and watch a DVD and have a takeaway and a bottle of red. Okay, that's fine. No problem at all.
As long as it's English, right? The bottle of red.
No, the bottle of red can, in fact, be New World because we have an affiliation with the economy of Australia. Uh-huh. So I've got a problem with that one.
So you don't mind building up the economy of Australia?
Well, we're not building up the economy of Australia. What we're doing is the Queen is the monarch of Australia. She's Queen of Australia. Mm-hmm. So we have a joint purpose in improving both economies. And and get the sparkly jewellery because, honestly, believe me, most men can't tell the value of jewellery and neither can women, so you ain't got a problem.
All right.
In fact, I think it's a mistake to buy expensive jewellery sometimes because there's no difference between expensive jewellery and cheap jewellery.
Well, it's worth a lot more. Darren says this on Facebook. My wife is due to give birth to our first baby in the next 2 weeks. Does Porky have any advice on how I could be as supportive as possible through labour?
Well, I wouldn't be in the same room as your wife when the baby's being born. I think that's too traumatic for all concerned, OK? Having said that, you have to understand that after your baby is born, your wife might slip into what's known as post-birth blues or some sort of depression. What do they call it?
Yeah, they do. Postnatal depression.
Yeah. And you must be as supportive as possible. Probably the best thing you can do is not to take the traditional path to celebrate your baby's birth, which is bladderation, and pursue a policy, please, for the first month after your child is born of non-bladderation.
OK, here's one from Frazzle. Mike, not wishing to tempt fate, but which non-Beatles song would you like to be played at your funeral?
That would be, in fact...
Maybe that Top Gun song.
No, not a Top Gun song. It would be Abide With Me, written by Elgar. Abide with me, fast falls the evensong.
Eventide.
Eventide, that's the one, yeah.
Okay. It's by Elgar.
Right, come on, next question.
Dorian says this. This Saturday will be Man City versus Liverpool on TV, and at the same time, Barcelona versus Real Madrid.
Yes.
Which match should I watch?
You watch Manchester City versus Liverpool, because although Barcelona and Real Madrid, the El Clasico, is of interest, it's not of massive interest. It doesn't affect the top of the league table in this country. And what's more, we don't have any close, warm relationship with most of the players in the Barcelona and Madrid teams. Most people only watch the Clásico because of two players, and they are obviously Ronaldo, who used to play here, and Messi, who didn't. Mm. So I'd stick to Liverpool, Manchester City.
Well.
Gareth Bale, of course, absolutely right. Mm. He used to play here, and I'd stick to Liverpool, Manchester City because it's much more relevant to what happened
But not if you don't support either one of them.
It is, because it affects your teams. I support Everton, but I want to know how Everton are going to...
Well, if you support a team in the Championship?
Well, if you support a team in the Championship, it's good entertainment because it's a home-based classic fixture.
I see. Mm. Mark says this on Facebook. If you write a book about failure and it doesn't sell, is that a success?
Of course not, because if you lose out on anything and fail, then that's not a success. Remember, if you're not winning in this world, it's almost certainly because you're not trying hard enough. So if you write a book and it doesn't work, scrap it, write another one, and keep writing books until you can sell one that is a bestseller.
Is that what you're doing?
That's what I've done. That's what I did. Mm. That's what I did.
Ah, okay.
Okay.
Joseph says, what did God do before the creation?
Before the creation, God was preparing for the creation. And that's why the famous expression, and on the seventh day God rested, is all about the fact that it's hard work putting the world together. And so you know, Rome wasn't built in a day. Earth wasn't really created in 6 days. There were billions of years of preparation before that happened.
Yeah, here's one from Cameron on Facebook. It's a question about a dog, actually. Mm. We adopted a 10-month-old rescue dog called Simba at the weekend. So does the esteemed dog expert extraordinaire have any tips for us, especially to stop him peeing against an ornament in the hall, which he thinks is a wall?
Well, what sort of dog is it?
He's a rescue dog.
Well, it's a rescue dog. What breed is it?
Well, it's probably a mongrel. It's a dog that's been rescued.
Mongrel?
Well, probably, yeah. Mongrels. It's probably not a pedigree dog if it's been rescued dog rescue centre.
I would say, as with any dog, you have to let the dog know who's in charge. So you do a bit of dog whispering. You don't intimidate your dog. You don't bully your dog. You don't shout at your dog. You give it some firm instructions. For instance, you want to make absolutely sure that every night when you sit down to watch Coronation Street, your dog brings you your slippers.
Uh-huh. OK, how about this one from Macahil? I want to get my girlfriend to love the Two Mics show as much as me. Where would be a good starting point to get her into the Two Mics? The DVD, the live show, the podcast. Should I take her to a show? I think by the live show, he means a live radio show.
Yes, I would say all of the listed above.
Well, first, you can't do all of them, can you?
You can. You can have a great rock and roll night, right, with a few bottles and some pizza ordered in, and munch your way and drink your way through the night, listen to the live show. You can, the following day, maybe not extend your night right the way through the night and pick up the DVD, which you'll love because the slight bit of editing in that makes it easy listening. And then definitely get up onto the Two Mics website and find out where our next available show is. And we're just drawing the list now of live shows for 2016. And get along there.
OK, here's Adam from Leicester, who's texted into 81089. Hi, Mike. Does Porky think Tyson Fury has a chance against Vladimir Klitschko on November the 28th?
No, I'm afraid I don't.
No.
And I think Tyson Fury is a very intense man and in some ways has some very strange views. I'm not against that because I don't like people to conform all the time. But I feel that he's almost deranged in his attitude towards Klitschko, who's going to beat him quite soundly.
Mm. Here's one from James. He says, my 7-year-old son Jack is a new and huge Two Mics fan.
Right.
He'd like to ask Porky why he always argues with old MG.
Well, it's not that I argue. It's just that MG has a sense of total irresponsibility towards life to an extent where I feel it could affect the lives of other people. Now, impressionable young people aged 7 need a moral compass. They need guidance. I've already explained how MG's moral compass doesn't exist, how his guidance facility, his guidance relationships towards his own boys, one of whom's only a year or two older than the 7-year-old chap that we're talking about, is non-existent. And therefore, I have to argue with MG to make sure he stays on the straight and narrow.
Because he knows so much about children, of course. Now,
I do.
Here's one from Emlyn, who says, I'm looking after my granddaughter and need to wash her white school blouses. Mm. How long do I boil them for?
Well, she boiled them for about 12 minutes. My mum used to have what's called a dolly tub, and she used to put it on the old gas cooker and boil it all up. She had a pair of wooden tongs, which she used to push into
Did not make it very steamy in the house?
Yes, it did a bit, yeah, but she used to leave the kitchen door and windows open. And the wooden tongs, she used to, you know, push my white shirt, my white school shirt, yeah, and my white school...
It's like a laundry in there.
White school PE kit, in particular. She used to push it down into the bubbling water in which she'd put the soap powder, you know, and boil it all clean. And that's why I was always complimented at school by Mr. Clamp, who was our PE teacher. Are you laughing at?
Well, his name's very
funny. Mr. Clamp, who used to say I had the whitest PE kit. And by the way, Emlyn, it's a lovely name. I take it it's probably in some way a tribute to the former Liverpool captain, Emlyn Hughes, who, of course, was also England captain.
Yes, I think
it's a Welsh name, by the way, because his father was a Welsh rugby league player.
Yeah, all right.
Yes.
Yeah, we're out of time now.
Barrow-in-Furness, I think he played for.
Yeah. Well, yeah, I think he was from Barrow-in-Furness.
Yeah.
That was Ask Porky. Same time but next week, we'll have loads more of your questions. And I'm sorry if we didn't get to read any of yours out. We try to pick the best ones and keep sending them in. We very much appreciate it. Coming up next, I'm going to ask Porky about whether he's going to lend me some money to buy a houseboat.
Hey, great.
Drive on Talk Sport, the UK's only sports-dedicated drive time with Sky Sports. The sharpest analysis on all the day's action.
Say I'm angry is an understatement.
Laser-guided comment and rapid reaction from a nation of sports fanatics.
I don't like listening to them, I'll turn off.
Drive home with Darren Goff and Adrian Durham, weekday afternoons from 4 on Talk Sport with Sky Sports, the home of the Barclays Premier League for the next 4 seasons.
The BMW i3. It's not just an electric car. It's an electric car that drives like a BMW. Rentals from £299 per month. Discover more at bmw.co.uk/i3. £3,699 initial rental. 36-month hire agreement from BMW Financial Services. Subject to status and availability for new vehicles ordered before 31st of December 2015 and registered by 31st of March 2016. UK-only guarantees may be required. Mileage and other conditions apply when you return the vehicle.
You own this place?
Yes. And you are?
Winston Wolfe, Direct Line. So you're a landlord, a property magnate, a wise guy.
I wouldn't go that far. It's just my wife's old flat.
But you have Direct Line landlord insurance with buildings cover, right? After all, if your boiler breaks down, they'll pay to repair or replace it.
No.
Oh, maybe not such a wise guy.
Boiler cover as standard with buildings cover. Can your landlord insurance do that? Search Direct Line Landlord. Excludes wear and tear. Underwritten by UK Insurance Limited.
Believe it or not, your business could claim a staggering tax deduction of up to 230%. Sound interesting? If you undertake any research and development, you may well qualify for this attractive HMRC-approved relief. The key criteria is being innovative and advancing knowledge in your field of business, whatever that may be.
Don't let your business miss out. Speak to Barnes Roof, clever accountants for business. Visit barnesroof.com/radio.
Talk Sport.
And it's in!
A diving header at the end of a 50-yard run.
From the root to the tip.
Talk Sport.
Estuary! I live in a houseboat on an estuary. Which is handy for my work with the Thames Water Authority. But I know
this is Talk Sports. We are the two mics. There will be a podcast coming out a little bit later on, of course. We've got Porky Vision coming tomorrow.
Mm-hmm.
And we haven't really decided on a quiz yet, but I'm not going to ask you to do that necessarily.
Why not? You need some preparation for it.
Well, the quiz masters need preparation
yes.
for it. But so if you want to pick a subject, by all means,
yes.
go for it. You know?
Yes,
but
yes.
But like I said, I don't want to necessarily rush you.
What about... I tell you what I was thinking. I forgot actually what I was thinking. I was thinking something, yeah, something very good as well. I can't remember what it is now.
Right.
No.
Well, have a think about it.
While I mention
to you, I don't know if I should give away the name of this. I saw this picture of a boat, which is not really a houseboat that you'd see on a canal. It's more of an ocean-going houseboat because it's basically designed for someone to live in.
Oh,
right?
Really?
These are supposedly becoming all the rage because you can buy one for less than the price of a London flat, which they say is 240,000 quid. Because your average London flat now, even for a studio, is about 250,000.
Well, that's
so I was
very
thinking,
small
you know, this
one,
could
yeah.
be good for me, because basically I could...
Where would you moor this thing?
Well, I could moor it on the Thames, right, near where I am.
Surrey Quays, yes.
Yeah, because there's plenty of docks areas around there.
Yes.
And then I could take it down to Sussex, you know, like the long way round, out to the Thames estuary, because it's an ocean-going boat.
Oh, I
and
see. So it's not just something you anchor to the floor of the river? Like...
No, because, I mean, you know, there's something called Limehouse Basin.
Yes, I know Limehouse Basin. Narrow Street.
Yeah, Narrow Street, yeah, where they used to have the grapes and the great fish and chips and all that.
Yeah. Well, they still haven't got the grapes, though.
Well, yeah, I just haven't been there for a long time. I used to go there quite a lot.
There was a famous chef who opened a restaurant there.
Yes, Gordon Ramsay opened place.
Gordon Ramsay, was that the one?
Well, that was
one. No, I don't think it was. It was the other guy with the fluffy hair. You know, the guy who does the stock advert, you know, now your food can be as good as mine.
Marco Pierre White.
Almost. Marco Pierre White. I'm
sure
he had a place. Yeah, I'm pretty sure.
No, I think there's a Grapes by Gordon Ramsay, which is there, but there's the Old Grapes, which is further down, which was a better one. Anyway, it's not about that. It's about when...
There's also a pub down there called The House That Was Left Behind.
Ah, okay. Is that the house where Dickens had a little room at the top?
No, it's a pub and they bombed everything else around it. That was the one left, the house that was left behind.
All right, interesting. Yeah. Well, anyway, you occasionally we'll see a narrow boat coming out of Limehouse Basin into the Thames.
Right.
And I'm always terrified when I see it, because if the Thames is running high and it's quite tidal, this thing bounces about and it's only designed to go on a canal, right?
Right, OK.
These things, and they're made by a company that, I'm not going to give them a name away yet. Yeah. It might be, giving them too much publicity. Mm. But they've designed these houseboats which are ocean-going.
Right.
So basically they're broader than... there's a picture of one there. There's three different kinds
you can
get.
Well, how far can you go?
Well, you can go as far as you like.
Well, you couldn't go across the Atlantic.
Well, I don't want to go across the Atlantic.
So where do you want to go?
I just want to go to Sussex. So I could go out of the Thames estuary and then down and around sort of Dover and Rye and all of that, and then come around back into sort of Hastings.
It's a long way to go home. Why not just get on a
car? I wouldn't use it all the time. Yeah. I wouldn't use it all the time. But all I'm saying is it would be quite an interesting way to live. And also, in order to sort of, for many people not to be on the London housing ladder, why spend money to get on the London housing ladder when you can have a house literally that moves?
Yeah, but you know these
things. So what I'm asking you is, would you lend me the money to get one?
No, because it's a very poor investment.
How do you mean it's a poor investment?
These things always have huge problems. For instance, what's the source of power on a mobile houseboat?
Well, it's an engine, like everything else.
No, it's not.
Yeah, it is.
What, you see, a generator?
Yeah, here we go.
So where would you get your, your paraffin from?
This is great. Look, it looks like a James, Bond scenario, doesn't it?
Yeah, it's ridiculous.
Why is it ridiculous?
Because you can't live on one of those, moving around on water, you fool.
Why not?
Have you ever been on a houseboat?
Yeah, of course I have.
Well, what do you mean, of course you have? Not many people have been on a houseboat.
What do you mean, like one on a canal?
Well, I mean one that's moored in. I mean,
yeah, but you're talking about a narrowboat, right? Those are the
things. No, I'm not talking about a narrowboat. You're talking about a houseboat.
A houseboat where?
Well, for instance, if you in certain parts of Stockbroker Belt, Surrey, if you know Eel Pie Island and all that down near Thames Ditton,
used to be,
and all that. Yeah, the sides of the rivers there are full of houseboats.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
And they're square houseboats. Yeah. They're not narrow boats or anything like that.
Yeah, but they don't move.
They don't move, no.
Yeah. This is a boat that moves,
well,
right?
It's ridiculous.
Here's what it's got. It's got a king-size bed. Obviously, that appeals to me. Yeah. It's got a VIP ensuite cabin. Mm-hmm. So you should like that because, you don't have any kind of VIP suite.
Well, that's just like a lounge, isn't it?
Well, it's got an ensuite. It's an ensuite bathroom.
Oh, an ensuite bedroom, okay,
ensuite bathroom.
Right.
Extra living space. Mm-hmm. And it's got a fly bridge. Whether it's nice evening dinner or a lounge gathering with your friends or sunbathing or an afternoon barbecue, you store all your water sports toys and you can basically, have a party on the deck.
That sounds
I don't know why he's so
me.
Against it.
Well, because it's so impractical. It's ridiculous. Well, when you live on water...
Look at that.
Yeah.
See, look at the, it's quite wide. You can see you can have sun.
Yeah, but that looks like the sort of thing that, honest to God, belongs in the Mediterranean. It doesn't belong in the waters around the coast of Great Britain.
Why not?
Because the waters get stormy and it lash water over the side and all that, you idiot.
When was the last time you saw a tsunami in the Thames?
Well, you don't, but you see bad weather and rain and all that kind of stuff. I mean, look, whenever you live anywhere near water, you're going to be susceptible to rats, OK? You get overrun by rats all the time.
Yeah, look, there's a section here on seaworthiness.
Yeah, OK. Now, a mate of mine lived in one of those...
The concept of a catamaran, sea-kindly hull design, and its wide beam makes Overblue a very efficient and stable yacht at sea.
Yeah, rubbish.
It's got a smart electrical system, right?
Yeah, it's a boat. That's not a house. It's a boat.
It's got a smart electrical monitoring system, allowing the owner to monitor most of the everyday onboard activities from one simple screen.
Oh, right. That's brilliant, isn't
it? Constant supply of 230 100 packets, 110 VAC.
What's that? What's VAC? Is that electricity?
Yeah.
I suppose so, yeah. Now, what I was going to say is, I had a mate once. He worked on the London Evening Standard when I was an up-and-coming, young, thrusting reporter on the Birmingham Mail in charge of their London office. And he invited me to a party on his houseboat. And he lived in what they call, a basin, right?
Yeah.
At the end of... I think it's the end of the King's Road, isn't it? Where there's a... Oh, no, was it Lower King's Road or something like that? Anyway, it's down there somewhere. And, it's near Chelsea Harbour. Just remember, it's near Chelsea Harbour. Yeah. Near Chelsea Harbour. And you go on it, but it smells of damp.
But this is a different kind of houseboat. This is what I'm telling you. It's not some ramshackle old piece of wood that's rotting.
It smells of damp. It bounces around. There's rats all over the place.
Have to pay council tax either.
No, I know, and it's an eerie feeling sleeping in
I'm shocked you don't want to help me buy one of these.
Do you know what? You know where you live, Surrey Quays.
Yeah.
Is there still a floating pub there called the Wibbly Wobbly?
Not that I'm aware of.
Well, there is a Wibbly Wobbly, or there used to be. I used to have an associate down there, okay?
An associate?
Yes.
Well, a woman?
Yes.
A woman?
Yes. And we used to go down
was
there,
she married?
Right? I used to walk from.
Was she married?
No, she had
Why are you
been,
hesitating?
But she wasn't. She had been, but she wasn't.
She had been married?
Yes, yes, yes.
Was she a secretary?
No, she wasn't. No, 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 no. She was executive. Now, what I'm saying is, there's a railway station down there called East something.
Eh?
East London Railway Station or something?
No.
There's something down there, anyway.
There
and I used to walk from there down a couple of paths near to the water, and then on the way home to where I was going, or to her home, rather, there was a lovely little floating pub called the Wibbly Wobbly.
Never heard of
and,
it.
And we'll have a look and see if it's still around. It is in Surrey
Keys.
Are
you sure Keys. That wasn't the sort of the fake name for it?
No, it was called the Wibbly Wobbly.
Well, if you could give me a rough location which doesn't involve some railway station that doesn't exist.
But loads of people...
East London Railway Station.
Loads of people know the Wibbly Wobbly. And
look
they
at the inside
there.
Of that. That looks great. You would like one of these.
Yeah, let me have a look, please. Yeah.
You see, now you like it because it looks luxurious.
Yeah, but I mean that's so false. That's you'd have one of these, right, to move around in, providing you had £1 million house on land. But you wouldn't just live on that. That's
why
ludicrous.
Not? I don't see why not.
Yeah, that's ridiculous. Ridiculous.
So you're not even interested in exploring the possibility of the investment value.
Well, I'm very happy to offer you money as a sort of repayment rate of 25% or something like that, you know? That's not a problem. Like and if your boat sinks, that's
typical,
tough luck.
Typical slum landlord.
Tough luck, you know?
Now, so, now's your chance. You've got about a minute and a half to come up with a quiz subject for tomorrow.
For Thursday. I was thinking about... tell you what you could do. Mm-hmm. I'm happy to do, because we speak to Sandra such a lot, the development of Australia.
What?
Australia.
The development of Australia?
Yes. Yes, I'm happy to do that.
It's a bit of a big area.
No, it's not really. No, I'm okay with that. Okay?
The development of Australia.
Yeah, okay.
All right.
And then, you know, maybe if we get Sandra on that night, she can, you know, compliment me on my knowledge.
Well, she won't be able to because the quiz would come after she was on.
Well, that's all right. She can wish me luck, can't she?
We had Sandra on last week, anyway.
Did
we? Her again.
Yeah, why not? Why not? It's great to have her on.
Yeah.
Right, okay, so it's going to be Australia, right?
Okay.
Yeah, that'll do.
How did you phrase that?
The development of Australia.
The development of Australia.
Yes, that's right.
Well, it can mean anything.
Well,
I might get misinterpreted.
Well, you think about it. You're okay? Mm. Yeah, good.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Right.
Can't see a problem there at all.
Becky, by the way, New Zealand, has thanked us for already receiving the DVD of this.
I know, that's
show.
Fantastic. I'm just sending a note
out
here.
It's got from to New Zealand in 4 days.
I was going to say, like to see the Two Mics Live DVD has reached NZ in just 4 days, is it?
4 days.
Yeah, I'm sending this out right now. Reached NZ in
You don't have to read
days.
It out because we're running out of time.
No, don't worry. People are interested in this.
No,
they're interested.
They're interested in us hitting the news on time as well.
Okay, yeah, okay, we'll do that then.
Thank you very much indeed.
If you love the Two Mics podcast, you'll love the live show. Weekday overnights from 1 a.m. on DAB Digital Radio and 1089 and 1053 a.m. and via the TalkSport app. TalkSport, your Premier League station with exclusive commentaries every weekend.
What an absolute corker!
Talk Sport.
We've got plenty of time.
No, we haven't. Look at
yes,
the time.
Yes, you have. I can make time.
No,
you know,
how
I
do you
can
make
I can
time?
Invent time.
Can you?
Look at the light!